sponsors. So thanks to National Scene, WPLN, and NowPlayingNashville.com for their help in getting the word out about the festival as well. I also want to say a big thank you to Nashville Public Television. They are great roommates in many ways, and one of the ways they are is that they help us with the equipment that we need to be able to live stream the readings that you're seeing on HowlRound TV. So we're on the internet right now. So thank you to Nashville Public Television for that. And of course, my thanks would not be complete at all without saying thank you to the person without whom we wouldn't be here in any way, shape, or form. This woman believes in the American theater. She believes in the importance of new works toward keeping the American theater lively, and she puts her money where her heart is. So of course, a big thank you to Martha Ingram for coming. Tennessee Rep is about to be 30 years old. It's our 30th anniversary next year. I know. And so one of the things that we're doing to help that celebration is we're launching something new, a membership program. So if you're a supporter of Tennessee Rep, we've incorporated a whole bunch of ways that you can actually interact with us in cool ways. That sounded really enticing in a way I wasn't sure how that would come out, but you should go online and see what I mean. and there are different levels of membership. So we hope you'll consider being a member with Tennessee Rep for in celebration of our 30th anniversary. And while you're online looking at information, you can just pop over to the subscription page and buy a subscription if you haven't done that yet. We have a great season next year, so we hope you'll look into it. I also want you to know we're having a fundraising party on Sunday, so if you really enjoyed us this season, you'd like to have a chance to mix and mingle with the actors who made this season possible, we hope you'll join us for a River Reprieve on Sunday evening. It's a dinner and entertainment, and there's plenty of information about that both in the back room and online, so we hope you'll consider looking into that. The cast of company is going to be doing some singing, so you can come and do that. All right, a quick overview of the Ingram New Works Project. It has three parts. A fellowship, a lab, and a festival. The fellowship is something we offer to a playwright of national repute whose work we admire and who we firmly believe will continue to make important contributions to the American theater. And we were so honored this year when our fellowship was accepted by the Pulitzer Prize-winning, Tony Award-winning playwright Doug Wright. And he's right back there. I would like to recognize those four playwrights. We've had such a great time with them this year. So there's Nate Eppler. Nate? Actually, the proceeds for concessions support our professional internship program, so you can justify those M&Ms for a very good reason. And lastly, please check, if you will now, make sure that your cell phones are silenced. Go ahead and turn them off, if you will. I promise you, you're far too engaged in what's going on to worry about what's on your phone, so we appreciate that. Thanks again for being here. It really means a lot to us to have the privilege to work with these playwrights and have a part of getting them born, and I hope you'll feel the same way after you see these works. I know that you will, so thank you so much for your support of New Works. So now enjoy, please, Good Monsters by Nate Eppler.
Good Monsters by Nate Eppler. Act 1. Tuesday, nighttime. A backyard about an hour north of Nashville, but still south of Kentucky. It's in the kind of house that when they moved in, they thought they'd live there a year, tops. That was 4 years ago. A charcoal grill, weeds, dirt, trash, a pile of broken TVs, a kiddie pool, a new 30-pound bag of rock salt. There's a sliding door into the house and a window that looks out onto the yard from the kitchen. The word bad is smeared on part of the house. It's pretty dark out, but we can see it. Frank is trying to wash it off. Frank is around 40 and built like a guy whose nickname is Frankenstein. Dump truck is in a lawn chair drinking a beer. He's about the same age as Frank, and even out of uniform, you can tell he's a cop.
It's like everybody dies, nobody learns a lesson. Fuck.
Yeah.
All right, you feel like the best scenario is you're on the other side of the parking lot when it happens, right? But I say, maybe you were supposed to be there, okay? Everybody's all like, wrong place, wrong time, or this is a fucking capital T tragedy. But had it not happened, who knows what she'd have gone on to do, okay? Still be out there doing whatever the fuck she'd be doing, right? Maybe next time she does have a gun. Maybe next time she shoots somebody, okay? And we're like, what? Supposed to wait? I mean, right? Can't shoot till we get shot? Whoa, what is that? We ain't still over there, are we? No, we're over here, man. Different roads. Had you not done what you did, I can guarantee you some real bad shit would have gone down as far as she's concerned. No ticking time bomb or whatever. Because as she got away with it, why would she have, you know, been like, I'll never do that again, right? She wouldn't. She'd be like, I got away with it. Let's escalate this motherfucker. Had you not been there, had she lived, she wouldn't have known what would have happened. The only opportunity for her to like, make a change in her life or learn a lesson is she dies. But then she don't learn it because she's dead. It's messed up. I'm saying I don't see this as your fault, man. I don't see how nobody else can either. You're a good man.
And the civilian board, what, postponed?
Yep.
Administrative leave without pay.
Yeah.
Ain't nothing you can do about it. That's some bullshit right there. You're a goddamn vet. Everybody else is on your side, though. Captain's on your side. We got your back.
Captain wants me to see that guy again.
Fitness evaluation?
Pretty sure it's more than that.
All right, well, I hadn't heard that. You want another one?
Dump truck moves toward a small red cooler.
Hey, that's not... There's none in there. That's it. Start leaning. There's more in the Florida room.
Frank moves the cold cooler away from dump truck and slides open the door. He walks inside to get a beer for dump truck.
I don't see why you had to be out there moonlighting in the first place.
Shit, Ray, money.
Yeah.
Dump truck looks at the graffiti. Frank returns with a beer for dump truck.
The fucking kids.
Frank goes back to scrubbing.
Why are you just getting around that now?
We're just going to do it again, right? Every time I get it off, you know, they just... But Darlene says it's got to come down, so...
Well, what do you think they put it on the front of the house so everybody can see it when they drive by?
I think it's just for me and Darlene.
You use the hose.
I'm using the hose.
Yeah, but you're not.
The faucet's working. The hose just ain't doing... I mean, look, there's like a kink in it or something. No pressure.
You got a broken hose.
How do you break a hose?
I'm not a plumber, man.
Well, me either.
Maybe if I knew one then, huh? Probably don't want you down at the Walmart, though, huh?
Yeah, probably not.
You been back there?
No.
Yeah. You go to Ace, though. They got hoses.
I'm supposed to stay. I mean, Mark Shane says I can't go nowhere, man.
Well, Lowe's got hoses. You told me I'd have got you one when I picked up all that fucking rock salt.
Yeah, thank you. I know
it's... I told you whatever you need, right? I meant whatever you need. That's the deal.
It's for the ants.
It's a 30-pound bag, Frank. Like a shitload of ants, huh?
I got to ring the whole yard. I read it on the internet. Darlene, you know, she just wants me to take care of it, you know?
Look, if you want me to go back out and get you a hose, I'll go back out and get you a hose, but you can't hide here forever. Know what I mean?
Just till the tribe.
Well, when's that going to be? I mean, when's Mark Shane figuring it?
Yeah, I'm sorry, man. I'll quit asking questions.
Dump truck drinks. Frank Scrubs.
Didn't she have parents? Where are they in all this?
She got dad for sure.
Like a real one from over there and all, or like adopted?
Pretty sure adopted.
All right.
Calls sometimes.
Who does? The dad?
Yeah.
What, here? What the fuck is he calling here for?
Says he got a gun. Says he's gonna come over.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. He's threatening you.
Not exactly.
What's not exactly?
Says he's gonna come over and shoot himself.
Here?
Yeah.
Why would you shoot yourself in somebody else's house? Don't make no sense.
That's what he says.
Well, that's just dumb. Shoot yourself at your own house. Or like at your office. Wait, so he gonna break into your house and shoot himself and you don't get shot first or nothing? He just like leaves you be?
Yeah, but not in the house, in the backyard.
Why the backyard?
He didn't say.
But he said the backyard.
Yeah, he was specific.
Fuck that shit.
Things pretty messed up, man. Fucking grief. Lost his daughter, right?
Adopted daughter. What? I mean, what's it got to do with you, besides the obvious?
I think it's just the obvious.
I think maybe he's the one writing on the side of your house twice a week.
Pretty sure it's kids, man.
Let me stake it out.
No.
Come on, man. I'll park the prowler like two blocks over and hide behind Big Frank's TV collection and scare shit out of him.
No.
Fine.
Dump truck drinks. Frank Scrubs.
You don't know how it went down. It was you and it was her. And yeah, in the 2020 hindsights or whatever, yes, she didn't have a gun, but didn't nobody know that till after, so you got lethal. We could have gone another way. Who cares? I'm more like, let's move along and figure out what's going to take to get you out of this backyard and back on the job, okay?
A light near the door flickers like a strobe and then goes out.
Right? You all right?
Yeah, sorry. I didn't know what that was.
I'll get you light bulbs when I get you hose.
I thought it was... I don't know, man.
It's cold, man.
Stress.
Fuck your name.
It's like not a whole lot making sense right now, that's all.
Hey, when stuff don't make no sense no more, you gotta make it make sense, know what I mean? I just choose, man. I don't care if it's true or not. Can't live upside down forever. It's after 9.
Oh, she'll be out. She's always running late. I don't think they care too much.
Mm-hmm. I don't know how you do it, man.
Always been like this. It's the arrangement we got.
Yeah, but right now... all the shit going on, I think you have her down at First Assembly of God every damn day or something.
Thank you for giving her a ride. What?
What?
What are you laughing at?
Nothing. It's funny. I don't know, man. Some things get laughed at, some don't. Don't everybody have no wild time. Shit.
Okay.
It's just... not like I'm dropping her off at school, man.
Darlene enters. She's wearing a jogging suit and high heels. Too much makeup, big earrings, big purse.
Quit cutting off the motherfucking air.
Hey, Darlene.
Not fucking around. Shutting off the goddamn 100 damn degrees in here. Hey, Ray.
Hey.
Got my blue light running into my eyes and look like a goddamn gay raccoon by the time I get there. Go turn on the air in the prowler.
Yeah. Okay. See you, Frank.
Yeah.
Dump truck exits into the driveway.
Why you gotta shut off the air like that?
I don't know. Been cold. Saw me get the shivers.
It's motherfucking July.
Think it's all right for you to be going out? On calls, I mean.
Why wouldn't it be?
I mean, with all we got going on, me not being able to be there.
You can't drive me no more because of the news vans.
But what if something...
You think my clients want to see that? I walk up there and there's like fucking news vans in the hotel parking lot. Private dancer means private, pretty sure.
Then maybe stripping in hotel rooms don't make sense right now.
But Don't everybody want to drive all the way to Nashville to see titties, Frank?
I'm saying if I can't be there to protect you, maybe we should just rethink the whole thing, like not do it for like a while, maybe.
Leave without pay.
I know.
That makes me the breadwinner. Whatever we gotta do, we gotta do. And that means making $400 every time I can make it. Pretty sure I won that argument, huh? I love you, Frankenstein.
Yeah, but...
What's my word?
Yeah.
What's my word?
Security.
Bing, 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 security. Whatever it takes, right? Right, the end. You gonna go see that guy tomorrow?
I'll be up when you get back.
That ain't an answer.
I mean, we can talk then.
We're talking now, ain't we?
Well, yeah.
You have to do that.
Yep, I know.
FOP is only going to go so far because this whole deal was off-duty, Frank.
I know.
That means you got to start getting paid as soon as damn possible. They can keep you out till it's all over, but you got to get something here, right? And by get something, I mean paychecks, right? And how do we start getting paychecks again?
Right.
So you going to go see that guy tomorrow?
Yeah.
Yeah. Look, I know it didn't go so well the first time, but you got to get back in there, okay? What are you afraid of?
Darlene.
Frank.
You're going to be late.
I love you. Bye.
Bye.
Don't be on the internet all night. That stuff will make you crazy.
Yeah.
Darlene exits. Frank scrubs. Later now. One of the TVs turns on. We see static, but it makes the wrong noise somehow. Frank walks over and turns it off. Zero enters. She's about 16 and Kuwaiti, but she's lived in the United States most of her life, so she's dressed like every other American teenager.
I know you're there. I can fucking feel you behind me. Please go away. Please, please just leave me alone. I'm gonna turn around and you're gonna be gone. I'm gonna turn around and there's going to be nothing there.
Boo.
Jesus Christ.
Hello, Frankenstein.
Why won't you leave me alone? Why do you keep coming here?
You break it, you buy it.
Okay. I want you to listen to me.
You like my love note?
Kids did that.
You didn't send me one back. I feel like you don't like me like I like you.
It's time for you to go away.
No.
If you're not going to go on your own, I'm going to...
Frank takes a folded piece of paper out of his pocket.
Go toward the light. You need to live in the light, so go on. Go on now. Don't get any closer, okay? You don't want... Listen to me now. If you go ahead and go now, I won't have to use the salt, okay? Just go to the light. I told you last night, if you came back, I'm not doing this anymore. You hear me? Please don't make me have to hurt you again. Please.
Do your worst.
Okay. Okay?
Frank gets the bag of rock salt.
Okay, you brought this on yourself.
Yeah, I'm the one that shot me in a parking lot.
You are threatening me. This is self-defense. This is justified.
Frank grabs the salt and tries to tear the bag open.
Probably need a knife to get the bag open.
Frank uses his teeth to tear the bag. He grabs a handful of salt and tosses it on the ground in front of him.
You see that, huh? Uh-oh. Well, fuck now, huh? This is for your own good.
Frank checks the piece of paper. Frank opens the bag wider. He starts to pour it in a circle around the stage, periodically checking the page to make sure he's doing it right.
What are you doing?
You aren't as strong as you think you are.
You, like, read about this on the internet?
It's gonna work.
I can't even tell you what I would do to, like, see the internet. Dad probably got into all my accounts so we could post Jesus stuff every 5 minutes. I bet my profile picture is, like, sun coming through clouds. You missed a spot.
What?
Right there.
I got it.
Yeah, no, because you didn't.
I'm pouring it out. I didn't miss anything.
Well, the stream skipped then.
I got it.
Yeah, but look.
Stop telling me what to do.
I mean, I don't care. It's your deal. If it doesn't work the right way, then...
Fine.
Frank goes back over the spot. Zero is inside the circle of salt now.
Am I supposed to be on the outside of the circle or the inside of the circle?
What?
Are you, like, trapping me in or, like, keeping me out?
Frank checks the paper. Probably it doesn't say anything about this.
It doesn't matter.
I'm pretty sure it matters.
But it doesn't.
Frank finishes the salt circle.
There.
Now what?
Now you, you know, you go into the light.
Maybe I was supposed to be on the outside of the circle.
It doesn't matter where you are.
You used the wrong kind of salt.
I didn't use the wrong kind of salt.
Why are you mad at me?
Go away!
No!
Please! You keep coming here and... What do you want from me? I'm not going to apologize to you. You could have had a gun.
Did I, though?
I'm not the bad guy.
I don't want an apology.
Then what do you want? Just tell me. Tell me what you want. I'll give it to you and you can just leave me alone.
I want you to kill yourself while I watch.
Stop it.
Death is lonely.
Listen to me.
Do you like being alone in the dark? I don't.
Please.
This way we don't have to be alone. Get your gun. I'll get started on the suicide note.
That's not happening.
Go get the gun.
No.
Bring it out here. We'll take a look at who you really are, and if you can listen to all of it and not blow your freaking brains out, you win.
Stop it.
Why? What's left? They're never going to let you be a cop again. And Darlene, she's just waiting for the right moment to jump.
Don't do that.
Don't get mad at me. I'm not the one that, like, married a hooker.
She's not.
You know how you guys got together. Why would she stick around?
Don't.
You're bad. They all know it, and you do too, don't you? It's just us. You can tell me the truth. You know you're the bad guy, right? Because you are the bad guy, right, Frank?
Frank throws a handful of salt at Zero.
Ah! Oh my god! Oh my god!
Shit!
It burns!
I didn't mean to.
Frank grabs her. He tries to brush the salt off.
Mommy? Mommy, where are you? I can't find you!
I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
I don't want to go into the light. Ah!
Ah! Little bitch.
He throws her down, hard.
Be nice.
Fuck you.
Zero stands. The light flickers. There's a buzz.
Stop that. Whatever you're doing, I want you to stop it.
The buzz gets louder. The light strobes.
You want to play with me, Frankenstein?
Stop it.
Let's play.
Stay back.
Zero jumps on Frank's back.
Peekaboo.
Zero covers Frank's eyes with her hands. The stage goes black.
Stop it!
We know who you are, don't we, Frank? We've seen your insides. Now all you have to do is crack you open for everybody else to see.
Leave me alone.
I will never leave you alone. Do you understand me? I own you. You are mine until there is none of you left. And when you have nothing left to give me, when I have brought you to your knees, when you are at my feet begging me to show you mercy, I will bend down and whisper in your ear, no, I'm not done with you yet.
The lights come back up. Zero is gone. The word bad is everywhere. On every surface, in every shape and size, over and over again, glowing. Frank is surrounded. The words fade, flicker, and go out. Frank is alone. Wednesday, daytime. Frank is sitting in one of the lawn chairs with his feet in the kiddie pool. Darlene enters with two TV trays, sets them up, goes back into the house. Darlene enters with some plastic cups and a 2-liter. She sets the stuff on one of the TV trays.
You're getting your Adidas all fucking wet.
What are you doing?
Where do you keep your shoes on?
What?
Hey, spaceman. You ain't allowed to be all checked out all the way, okay? Like you're missing shit. We got stuff going on here, for real.
Darlene tries to pull the kiddie pool away from Frank.
Hey, all right. Are we having company?
Okay, so I wanted to tell you, but I couldn't figure out how to tell you, and then I thought, well, maybe seeing as how you've been lately, it'd be better if you didn't know it was coming, but you asked, and I don't see lying to you about it.
We are having company?
Her name's Josie.
Whose name's Josie?
What? You know, I ran into her, and she's been following the case, kind of, because, you know, it's like everywhere, and she's sort of a lawyer.
We have a lawyer.
Yeah, I know.
We got Mark Shane.
Yeah, but, okay, well, Mark is sort of like, you know what I mean, sort of budget. You know how I said we can't buy Cheerios no more because Cheerios shouldn't be no $5 a box and we got to get Great Value Toasty Oats? Mark Shane is Great Value Toasty Oats.
Wait, what's going on?
So, we got Toasty Oats, but we're in a Cheerio situation.
Darlene.
It's So you need to talk to her. Trust me, she's gonna get us out of this.
Dump truck enters from the driveway. He's wearing his police uniform. He's carrying a hose.
Hey, hose delivery.
What are you doing here?
Hose delivery.
What?
The hose is broke.
What?
I asked Ray to go to Walmart and...
Oh, we don't shop there no more, period. And we don't want their products in our motherfucking house, okay?
Yeah, but...
No, this is not a discussion.
This one's from Lowe's, anyway.
Okay.
What?
Josie enters. She is dressed like a lawyer. Big sunglasses, big smile.
Am I in the right place? Darlene.
Who's this?
Hi.
Hey.
Come on in.
You're Frank, right? So nice to meet you.
This is her?
Oh, yeah.
I already have a lawyer.
You're a lawyer?
Look, we can... He really wants to talk to you.
I don't want to waste your time.
Cheerios, Frank.
Frank, I assure you, it is not my intention to circumvent, sidestep, your relationship with your current lawyer.
I know what circumvent means.
Okay.
Are you part of the family?
That's right.
Everybody calls me dump truck, on account I crap a lot.
So nice to meet you.
If he don't want you, pretty sure I need me a lawyer.
Could I sit down?
Yes, 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 of course. You want some coke? I went to pizza roll. Be nice, Frankenstein.
Darlene goes inside to get the pizza rolls.
You were in Iraq with Frank, right? Darlene told me she said...
Gulf War One.
Right, well, thank you for your service, both of you.
You're welcome.
Do you do TV repair, Frank?
Oh, those are big Franks.
Oh, uh-huh.
Where'd you meet Darlene?
Don't want to talk to me, huh?
Nope.
Okay. You know what? I'll go. You don't need me. Sorry to bother you. Who's your lawyer?
Mark Shane.
Okay. Well, I haven't heard of him. I bet he's good, though. He's good enough for you. He is good enough for me. Did the department help you retain him? Get his services?
Yeah.
Oh, good. Then he's looking out for them, too. Good. He's not your wife's lawyer, though, is he? I said he's not your wife's...
What do you want?
I don't want to bullshit you here, Frank.
Then don't.
I won't.
Okay.
I bet we agree on one thing.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Somebody's gonna pay this tab. Now, I don't want it to be you, but can it be you? Yes. Yes, it can. Is that preferred? How can I prefer that after getting to meet you and your lovely wife and dump truck here and learning all about your years of service, which again, I thank you for, but somebody's got to pay. No free lunches, like the man says. Dump truck, you agree? No free lunches?
I like her.
You say Mark Shane has your best interest at heart, is looking out for you, is looking out for the department. Fine, I believe you, but it stops there. Because he is not looking out for Darlene.
He'll do what's best.
What if what's best is you plead out and do 6 years? Who looks out for Darlene while you're locked up with all the other murderers down at Riverbend?
All right, you know what?
You're right. That's probably being dramatic. But what about the civil trial? Because there will be one. And it will not be cheap. And how do you pay for it, Frank? How do you save up for a legal defense when you're on indefinite leave without pay?
So Darlene just spilled it all, huh?
I don't know Darlene well, but I like what I've seen so far. I like her, and I've seen what happens when the bills pile up. It was a mistake in a parking lot, and if you're not very careful about how you handle it, you're going to be paying for it for the rest of your life.
I have a lawyer. I don't need another one.
Darlene enters with the pizza rolls.
I don't think you do. I think Darlene does.
You want to be Darlene's lawyer?
I am Darlene's lawyer. She hired me last night.
Last night?
You hired her last night?
Yeah. Yeah, it's gonna be sort of a surprise.
How was that a surprise?
You didn't know, and now you do. Not all surprises are ponies. Help yourself to these pizza rolls.
Hot.
Just come out of the oven, buddy.
We all want to see Darlene taken care of, don't we? We can agree on that much, right, dump truck? Don't we want to see Darlene taken care of?
Yeah.
We all agree, so I'm going to look out for Darlene. I'm going to make sure she is still standing on her own 2 feet by the time we get to the end of the trial.
Mark Shane says it won't go to trial.
Oh, won't it? Okay.
Have you watched television lately? The trial has already started.
What are you trying to get here?
This is a tragedy. Tragedy has a cost. And if it has a cost, it must be worth something.
See, this is the stuff that you need to hear.
Josie takes two magazines out of her bag.
Dump truck, do you know who this is?
That's that slut that's married to that rapper.
That's right. And do you know who this is?
Josie shows him a second magazine cover. Frank is on the cover.
Yeah?
Yeah. We all know who this is.
That's you, Frank. She made $10 million last year. How much did you make? You're both on the cover of a magazine this month. Surely you made about the same, right?
It was nice meeting you, but I think we're done.
When will it end?
Thanks, I've seen it.
I think a lot of people are asking themselves that question these days, but I guess that's not the question I'm asking myself. I get the question I'm asking myself is, why did you pick her up?
Okay.
After you shot her, you ran to the body.
We're done.
I've seen the security camera footage and the picture. Everybody's seen the picture. Here it is on the cover of Time. You lifted her into your arms.
I'm going inside.
You, holding the teenage girl you just shot. Tears in your eyes. Are you running towards something? Away from something? Or are you going for help? Or is that look just, I don't know, shock? There is something in your eyes here that I don't think I have ever seen before.
Fuck you, okay?
Everybody wants to know the story of this picture, and of course they do. I do. But you're not saying anything. So I suppose we're all sort of having to make it up as we go along, and I get it. You want to be the strong, silent type. But America doesn't like that anymore. We don't allow for silence. The void will be filled with or without you.
I don't have anything to say.
That's why you need me! Do you know how much your average reality star makes?
Now you want to put me on TV.
You're already on TV. In fact, you're a star.
Right.
This story isn't going away. We all want to know how it's going to turn out, and we're going to keep watching until we're satisfied.
Well, we are, huh? Okay.
Your show's a hit, and so far, you haven't been smart enough to be a part of it.
She is saying that they're making money off of you without you getting your fair share.
I got it.
They're doing it by making you look bad, Frank.
See? This, tell him. Right now, don't nobody know nothing about you except you shot that little girl that's in the picture.
I appreciate you coming by, but this is over, okay? We're not doing this.
I know you need me, Frank. Because I need you. I've been looking for the right kind of story to tell. I think people are willing to pay for the right kind of story.
I don't care what she says, okay? I'm not cashing in or whatever.
I don't think I'd call it cashing in. You're in an unusual situation, which has unusual costs. And there are unusual ways of generating the funds to pay for it.
How do we start?
Well, I think a website first. For the legal defense fund and expenses.
Cover your end first, huh?
People like donate, like over the internet.
I can guarantee $15,000 in the first month. First 2 weeks, maybe. That is, if we can get an interview right away. How does that sound? Could you use $15,000?
Taxes eat that up.
Hey!
Uncle Sam gets his taste, that's all I'm saying.
15's the low end. We can get more depending on Frank's level of participation.
What kind of lawyer are you?
I'm a crisis manager. Sort of a storyteller. All our good stories are failing us, Frank. Our fairy tales are suddenly worthless. The one about the guy who worked hard and got ahead. The one about the guy who did the right thing and was rewarded. The one about the guy who did his job and we all thanked him for it because it was what we asked him to do in the first place. But we desperately crave stories. How else are we supposed to make sense of a world turned upside down? So we take the shitty stories instead. The guy who did it on purpose. The crook who got away with it. The man who did just what we expected because he's a racist cop piece of shit. These are the stories we tell ourselves now, and we're telling ourselves that kind of story about you. I'd like to get in the way of that. I'd like to give them a reason. I'd like to give them an understanding. I'd like to give them a different story.
Like what?
For the rest of your life, you're going to be the man who shot that girl.
The next few months will determine if you were the racist monster who shot that girl or the hero cop who shot that girl. And we want to say in which it's going to be, don't we? So we define you. We have to get down to the center, you know what I mean? They won't buy it if you don't have some kind of damage, some kind of pain, something they can relate to, but not relate to too much. Like, relate to at a distance. Is there a word for that? Whatever that is, that's what we want. The thing at a distance. This is the pain. This is the original sin. This is what crosses your mind in the parking lot that night. And it doesn't even matter what it is because we all have it. We all have that thing, that pain at the center of us. And if you show us yours, we will see a reflection of ours. So when you get on your knees and say the I'm sorries and beg for forgiveness, they won't just say, yes, I forgive you. They'll say, yes, I understand why you did what you did. And in your place, in that moment, in that parking lot, I would have done the same thing. Now, do you want my help?
Yes.
It's a lot, isn't it? You don't have to decide right now. I'm at the Marriott by the highway. Darlene, thank you for inviting me over.
Look, he's just like this right now, okay? He's really for real interested, really.
Darlene.
Frank, thank you for coming by.
We'll talk again soon. I want there to be a happy ending. I want this story to have a happy ending. I think this story can have a happy ending. I want there to be one anyway.
Mm-hmm. We're thinking the same thing.
Good. Dump truck. So nice to meet you.
Yep.
Frank, thank you for your service.
Josie exits.
Asshole for. That woman is trying to fucking help us.
You met her last night.
You are going along with this. Do you hear me? Do you hear me? Are you giving me the motherfucking silent treatment? Because you do not give me the motherfucking silent treatment, okay? We talk about our shit.
Just
what?
Stay out of it, Darlene.
Stay out of it.
Maybe I'm gonna go ahead and go.
What in the name of sweet motherfucking Jesus Christ is wrong with you? Exactly.
Yeah, so I'm gonna go ahead and
because that woman is right, okay? I'm fucking sorry or whatever that little girl had to die, but this don't have to be all bad for us, okay?
So
Jesus, right? Go on and go for God's shit.
Yeah, so you good? Okay then. Bye, y'all. Thank you for the pizza roll.
Goodbye, yeah, right.
I'll see y'all on the floor.
You just wanna sit there and die? Is that it? Or are you gonna fight back? Fuck you.
Darlene exits into the house. Frank is left alone. He pulls the kiddie pool back over to where it was and puts his feet back in it. Wednesday night. Frank is alone with Zero. Frank is on the laptop. Darlene is probably in the house watching TV.
There are people, like, shopping there right now. Trampling over the spot where I freaking died like it never even happened. Like, stepping over my freaking memory on their way to get, like, Diet Cokes and Funyuns and shit. It should have, like, stopped. Like, all stopped forever or whatever, right? Like, they should burn that whole place to the ground. I mean, how could it all just keep going? That doesn't even make sense. Are you listening to me? Are you trying to figure out why the salt didn't work?
I can't hear you, okay?
Then why did you answer?
We're not talking.
We should get some drugs. I'm not an addict or anything. I'm just, like, freaking bored for real.
Is that why you were shoplifting? To get money for drugs?
I stole jeans from freaking Walmart. What kind of drugs could I buy with freaking Walmart jeans? Like, crap drugs, I'm sure, a jerk.
I'm sorry.
For insulting me or for, like, murdering me in a parking lot?
You know what? We're not talking.
Tell me a story about Kuwait.
What?
You were there longer than I was. I don't, like, know anything about it.
No.
Why are you treating me like we're not friends? Who could be, like, closer than us?
Please stop reading over my shoulder.
See, it says right there salt doesn't do much.
The sites all... a lot of sites say different things.
Hold someone's hand and repeat the following incantation. Oh, please ask Darlene to do that with you. Seriously, I would love to watch that conversation.
What you're doing is rude.
Go to my Facebook page.
No, just stand over there, okay?
Come
please.
Come on, I want to see what people are saying about me.
Please fucking goddammit!
Yes, I like it when you get angry. I feel like it gets us closer to the fireworks. Get your gun out.
I'm going
to
email this guy. And I'm going to get a fucking exorcist in here. Do you hear me? Okay, we're going to get a fucking exorcist and we're going to cast you out back to wherever the fuck you're supposed to be, okay?
You're like evicting me?
I'm going to exorcise you.
You're thinking Darlene will let you put it on the credit card? Or you figure that, like, the exorcist is going to do it out of the kindness of his heart or whatever? And for real, he probably wouldn't tell anybody he did it. I mean, it's not like you're famous right now or anything. It's not like you're all over the news every day for killing an unarmed teenager for no reason. You're not having second thoughts, are you? I only ask because you're being quiet, and I thought maybe you realized you were stuck with me, and so maybe just better do as I say. Is that what you were thinking while you were being quiet?
Fuck you.
Go to my Facebook, but it's not under Sapira, it's under Zero.
What?
They call me Zero.
Who calls you Zero?
Like, literally every single person, except Dad.
You let people call you Zero?
Yes, Frankenstein, I do.
Why? Why do they call you that?
Because my cousin, not my real cousin, but, you know, freaking perfect adorable Haley, couldn't say Sapira. Like, how hard is it to say Sapira? Like, not hard at all. And besides, Haley was 5, and for real, if I couldn't say something at 5, Dad would have, like, made me practice and shit until I got it right. But not Haley, because Haley's not adopted or whatever, and she's perfect. And freaking Uncle Harry and Aunt Linda let her do literally whatever she wants and have, I don't know, like, pictures of her every waking minute, like, for real. And so when she tried to say Sapira, she said Zero, and everybody thought, oh, isn't that so freaking adorable, or whatever. And I go, like, that's not my name. And they were like, we love Haley, and isn't she cute? Let's take some pictures. So it stuck.
Please go back to wherever you go when you're not here.
Right next to you is the only place I want to be. We don't have to look at the internet if you don't want to. There's other games we can play.
Stay away from me. I'm not going to do what you want me to do.
Of course you are. How can you live with, like, the weight of what you did to me? Where's your gun?
I got rid of it.
Yeah, no, you didn't.
Zero sits on the red cooler.
Get off that.
Frank sets it in a chair.
I wonder if I'd fit in that. I mean, like, now. You know, like, vacuum seal me down and shove me in there. How big was my casket? Did you see it? I bet it was freaking pink on the inside. Or, like, unicorn stickers on it. Freaking trapper keeper. He should have just burned me, poured me down a drain.
Stop talking like that.
Darlene is at the kitchen window.
What are you doing out there?
Nothing. Go back to bed.
Who are you talking to?
I'm not. I'm watching the internet.
Well, fucking turn it down, then.
Why are you yelling?
Because I'm still mad as hell at you.
It doesn't matter where you bury the dead. We still end up in the backyard.
I shot you. I did it. I'm a killer. I was afraid. I thought you had a gun. I thought you might have a gun. Because you were stealing. Because... And you didn't, and I know that now, but how could I? If you had had a gun, I would be dead. I would be dead. And they would be crying over my casket. Why didn't he even draw his sidearm? What kind of cop is that? What kind of man is that? How could he have not known that she had a gun? And you'd be, I don't know where you'd be.
I'd be at home doing homework.
You idiot. I even say that. It's not true. You'd be out, you'd be doing God knows what right now, and you're telling me that's better? I'm dead in the fucking ground and you're out doing crank with your boyfriend? That's better?
Yes!
Fuck you.
Would you do it again?
Goddamn right I would.
Then it's not an accident.
I did what I was supposed to do.
You're saying this is your job?
Zell enters through the gate. He looks pretty rough. He has his hands up.
Okay.
Hey. Who? No.
I want you to know.
Oh my God, what are you doing here?
I just want you to know I have a gun.
Zell lifts up his shirt. He has a gun in his waistband.
Hey.
It's my dad.
What?
I have it. I have it with me, but I'm not going to use it, okay? I'm not even going to touch it.
You need to put that gun on the ground now.
Sorry I didn't call first.
This is, like, so embarrassing.
I want you to know I'm waiting for him. He'll tell me what to do, and...
Here we go with the Jesus stuff.
Sir.
I'm not here to do anything. Not now. I'm sorry I didn't call first.
Put the weapon on the ground and step away.
It's okay. Don't worry. I'm not... Don't worry. I just wanted to tell you face to face.
You need to put that on the ground.
And I don't think I'm gonna hurt myself. I'm sorry about the phone calls. I've been scared. The house is... She was there and now she isn't. But not all the way. She was never very good at cleaning up after herself, so it's just piles. And so every room.
Nice. He's like criticizing me after I'm dead.
Without her there, it's very quiet. And I need that. That's made it good, because I'm listening really close. I've been listening for him. And I want you to know when he tells me what to do, I'm going to do it.
Sir, I'm going to count to three, and when I get to three, that gun is going to be on the ground, and we're going to have a problem here.
There's no way it's loaded.
Do we have a problem here?
However it ends up for us, you and I, bad or worse, I figure I only have to do it once.
Where did you even get a gun? I bet he had to, like, borrow it from one of those assholes at church.
I don't know why he does what he does, or why he asks what he asks. That's him. Invisible hands, mysterious.
One.
So mysterious, sometimes it feels like he might not even be there. I'm sorry. I don't know why I was laughing. That's not funny at all.
Two.
Three.
Frank pulls his gun out of the red cooler.
Put the gun down.
Wait,
now.
No.
I taught her to read.
Don't do that. Don't. Just let him go home.
Get out of the way.
She wouldn't have survived there. She was smaller than the others. I had to take her. I had to. It was everything I had. 6,000 in cash. And my belt. The tall man asked for my belt. When I gave him the backpack, I thought they might kill me. That's when it occurred to me. After the tall man already had the cash. I didn't think of it before. I was, I don't know, emotional. There wasn't a lot of logic to what I was doing right then. And they could have, too. They could have killed me. Nobody knew I was there, really. Everybody else was back at the hotel. The house was far away, off by itself. It smelled like dog shit. Small. Two or three rooms, I think. The other man was carrying Sophia, and I thought, well, if they shoot me, I hope they take her to one of those other rooms. Because I think that's something a two-year-old probably shouldn't see. I don't know what she'd seen before, really. Maybe she'd seen worse. Seeing a man get shot in the head? I thought that's something a two-year-old might remember. The tall man sat there and he counted the money and he looked at me and said, and your belt. It wasn't even a nice belt.
Please put the gun down.
No. I gave him the belt and we walked away. We walked out. I don't really remember. I know I had her up against my chest like a football. And I was... It's kind of funny. I had to hold my pants up with my other hand. I lost a lot of weight that year. My pants were too big. But we walked like that together until we could get somewhere. We'd get a car to take us to the hotel. Back to the hotel. She didn't cry. Oh, I did. I did cry. We got to the car, we got to the hotel, and we got to the room. And I thought, I didn't think, oh my God, what have I done? I didn't think that, you know? I think later, when I told the story, I told it that way sometimes, but that's not true. I didn't think, oh my God, what did I do? I put her on the bed.
You're safe.
I was wrong.
The blinds inside the Florida room open up. Darlene is standing there behind the glass door.
What the fuck is that?
Don't come out here, Darlene.
I think about killing you every day.
Why do you have a gun in your hand?
Did you hear me?
Hey, get the fuck out of here!
Stay right there, Darlene.
I'm calling goddamn cops. You hear me, motherfucker?
Darlene, you're not calling the cops.
The fuck I'm not!
Officer Wayne.
Nobody's calling anybody.
Get the fucking gun!
Officer?
Darlene.
Jesus Christ, Frank!
Just stay right there.
Officer.
I'm calling the fucking cops.
Don't call the cops!
Officer! I think about killing you every day. I'm gonna do whatever God tells me to do, but I hope he tells me to come over here and kill you. I don't know if that's the kind of thing he'll ask me. Mysterious ways. And I thought that you should know. Didn't seem like the kind of thing I should tell you over the phone. I'll call next time. Before I come over.
Zell exits.
Did you hear that? I only cost $6,000.
Darlene slides the door open and comes out. Cordless phone in hand.
What?
Put the phone down.
Darlene throws the phone at Frank.
What the fuck is going on out here? I hear you yelling and you got some motherfucker over here pointing a gun at you?
He wasn't pointing it at me.
Who the fuck was it, Frank?
It was Zero's dad.
Who the fuck is Zero?
Saphira, the girl.
That's her dad?
Yes.
And he come over here with a gun. I'm calling goddamn cops.
He's not coming back. It's over.
The fuck it is.
Nothing happened.
What do you mean nothing happened?
It didn't. There's just not... He's gone. It's fine.
What the fuck is wrong with you?
It's over.
Oh, hell yes!
What the fuck did you do that for?
Where are you?
I'm right here. Jesus!
Where'd you leave my husband?
Stop hitting me! Stop that!
You don't get to pretend this isn't happening.
What?
Wait, you want to play dad, huh? A man just showed up at your house to kill you, and you're just like, it's fine, no big deal, that ain't you.
He wasn't here. Darling!
What you gonna do? Nothing. Not gonna do a goddamn thing about it. You don't want to do anything. You don't want to fuck me anymore. You sure as shit don't want to talk about it, and you don't want to see anybody. You just want to hide in your little backyard until the sky falls down, huh? Fuck you.
Fuck you.
Fuck me what? Fuck me what? You see where we are here? You see what's on the goddamn line? There are people out there trying to send your ass to jail. We're just about as broke as I have ever been in my life. We got strangers wandering through the backyard looking to blow your motherfucking brains out.
God damn it!
We are gonna lose it all unless you wake the fuck up.
Go back to bed.
You won't lose me because I'm on the line too here, Frankenstein.
Yeah? Where would you go? Quit hitting me.
What you gonna do about it?
Darlene hits him again and again.
Stop it!
Fight back. Oh. Darlene hits him harder.
Ooh, that one made you mad. You gonna hit me?
Darlene, I swear to God, if you hit me again...
Why not?
She punches him.
God damn it!
Frank picks up the grill and throws it through the glass door. The grill breaks.
There. Happy?
Dead. I'm bringing that lawyer back over here tomorrow, and you're gonna play ball, or I'm gonna walk out that motherfucking front door. Do you hear me? I said, do you hear me?
Yes.
And the next time somebody wanders into my backyard with a gun, you come get me. I'll bury him out there and not think twice about it. You can just sit there and watch.
Darlene exits back into the house. Frank is alone on stage with Zero. The 4th of July. Parts of a cardboard refrigerator box cover the panel of the sliding door. The grill shattered. This end up is pointing the wrong way. Frank is on stage with Big Frank. Frank has a band-aid sort of across his eyebrow from where Darlene decked him. Big Frank is in a wheelchair, bald, big cataract sunglasses. He's in some kind of red, white, and blue sweatsuit. Big Frank is sitting in front of the TVs. Frank is on the other side of the yard. Dump truck enters, rolling a grill.
All right, motherfuckers, where the party at?
Oh, shit.
Sorry, Big Frank.
Goddamn, I didn't know he's going to be here, man. I'm sorry about that.
It's fine. Let me get that.
Frank grabs the grill from dump truck and rolls it into place.
Looking good, Big Frank.
Yeah, yeah. You
You got some cool new glasses, huh? Gonna be able to see lots better, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. They kind of look like a supervillain from one of them movies, huh? Kind of badass over here. You want to come over and hang out with me and Frank?
Dump truck tries to roll Big Frank away from the TVs.
He doesn't like it when you...
Okay.
Just let him.
Oh, I got you. Want to keep his eye on the stock, huh? Well, here you go, Big Frank. You just stay right here. I'm going to go over here with Frank and get this grill started up. What do you say? Yeah, that sounds good. Get you a hot dog. Can he eat hot dogs? We're going to have hot dogs, Big Frank.
Dump truck parks Big Frank with the TVs and goes over to Frank. Frank is putting charcoal on the grill.
Oh, here, man, let me help.
I got it.
No, yeah, but I mean, like, you know.
Geez, man, one person kind of job.
Okay. Yeah. Did you fall?
Yep.
Oh, okay. Okay. You all right, though?
Yeah.
Nothing,
Nothing what?
Going on?
Nope.
Yeah, good. You don't got nothing like you won't tell me?
Darlene tell you?
No.
God damn it.
Well, of course she fucking told me, man. Was it really that guy?
It wasn't no big deal. He's just messed up. No kind of threat.
He keeps fucking around like that. He's gonna get fucking shot, man. Shit. After your other ends with that family, you'd think he'd stay as fucking far away from you as he could, right?
It's fine.
You said you pulled a gun on him.
Well.
Did you?
Look, let me finish this here.
Look, I'm fine with it, okay? Fuck him. I'm just saying, maybe with all you got going on right now, maybe you shouldn't be fucking around with this.
Darlene exaggerated.
I just want to see you back on the job, man. I ain't gonna tell nobody about the dude coming over here.
Josie enters with a covered dish.
Dump truck.
Hey, Frank.
Hey.
It's macaroni salad. Where should I put it?
I'll take it.
Dump truck goes inside with the macaroni salad.
Well, who is this?
Oh, hey, no.
Darlene, that lawyer's here.
Is this Big Frank?
Yeah, he,
Nice to meet you, Big Frank!
He's not deaf.
Oh. Okay, Darlene led me to believe there were some medical issues.
Deaf ain't one of them.
I'm Josie King. I'm a friend of your son.
Yeah.
I like your TVs, Big Frank.
Don't. Just leave them alone.
Sure. How you feeling today, Frank?
I fell.
Fair enough. Darlene said we'd get a chance to talk a little today. And I think that's good.
She did, huh?
I think that's a good thing.
Well, that's great.
She said you were excited to... Well, we're willing to cooperate. Two of you had a chance to talk, I take it?
Uh-huh.
Great. Doesn't have to be formal, I think. Just a few questions. We want to be prepared.
Yeah.
Always be prepared, like the man says.
I'm going to get the grill going. We'll do it later.
The man also says no time like the present, doesn't he?
Look.
Your father did TV repair? He had his own shop?
Sort of. Yes, but...
Did he learn that in the Army? I saw that he was...
No.
He wasn't in the Army?
No, he was.
Oh.
But he already knew how to...
Oh, it said he was a radio operator.
He liked to take stuff apart even before he went in. The Army doesn't always teach you something new. Sometimes they just turn up the volume of what's already there.
And he was discharged...
OTH, doesn't it say that?
And what's...
Other than honorable, don't bother asking, because I don't know the details.
Is he why you went into the Army?
Like, Dad couldn't get the job done, so I had to go in and finish it up for him?
More like, was it a family tradition?
That's not why I joined up.
Sure. Okay, sure. And you never knew your mother, right?
What?
I said you never...
What the fuck did you just say to me?
I said you never knew your mother because she died while...
Yeah, I never really got to know her.
I'm trying to imagine the kind of questions we might get asked in the interview.
What interview?
What do you mean, what interview?
Darlene and Dump Truck enter. Darlene is wearing a skimpy star-spangled bikini. Dump truck.
truck is carrying a plate of hot dogs.
Here come the meat!
Josie, hey! Sorry. Look at you. Happy 4th, right?
It sure is.
Grill ain't hot yet.
Yeah, I didn't.
Maybe we could get you some shorts for the photos, though.
Photos?
Or a towel.
Don't worry, I got it.
Hey, no, man.
Do you want to get some photos of the family?
Maybe an America towel.
Well, we checked it right out today.
Photos for what?
Don't act like I didn't tell you. Did you meet Big Frank?
I did.
He's doing real good.
Good.
Frank said he didn't see getting the eyes under shit. What else has he got, right?
That's not what I said.
Yes, you did, Frank. Yes, you did. And I go, like, you're going to take away the one thing he's got? He's got to see his shows every day, right? Like, well, shit, he's even like that before the strokes, wasn't he?
My dad was exactly the same. Just the same.
Was he?
Just the same.
Right. Macaroni salad, Dumptrack said.
I wasn't sure what to bring.
That's great. All I got is potato.
Family recipe.
Oh, for real?
No.
Okay, I'm like, do I use too much lighter fluid or not enough? You know what I mean?
Won't light.
Josie grabs a camera out of the bag.
That's perfect. The two of you at the grill.
Cheese!
Josie takes a picture. Flash. Is it good?
Oh, it's up.
Well, I got it, man. You go ahead. You know, entertain your guests.
You know, we can do this later.
Less.
Frank can't wait to talk to you. Ain't that right, Frank?
Well, you know, there is a... Well, I'm not sure if it, but you know how they can be. I mean, they'll go to any length just to dig up the worst. And so what I said to Frank was, always be prepared.
Yeah, like a goddamn Boy Scout.
Exactly. I am so glad I met you.
No, it seems like we'd be friends even if it wasn't for this, right?
It does, doesn't it?
You know what, I'll let you.
No, I wanted to ask, and you too. Darlene.
Josie takes a file out of her bag.
Scott Michael Barnes. Scott Barnes, right?
Scotty Barnes?
Scotty Barnes, okay?
Well, nobody wants to talk about Scotty Barnes. Scotty's ancient goddamn history.
No, let's be careful about, let's not, we have to choose our words carefully. Uh-huh. We can't appear to be upset or to use upset words. Because this is what they do. They look for ancient history and sort of tie it to, well, you know what I mean. They try to upset us, and then they use that against us, too. Now, the facts are clear, of course, but...
Yeah.
Is that the file?
You drew your gun on and fired on Scott Michael... Sorry, Scotty Barnes at Concord Village Apartments. Is that correct? This is a little over 4 years ago?
Yeah, but...
And he was in the commission of a crime?
He had a gun.
This is the file that's in here.
Yeah, well, okay.
Was he in the commission of a crime?
He drew a gun on a police officer. He took a fucking shot at me, so yes, I guess he was in the commission of a crime.
A dog barked somewhere.
He shot a refrigerator?
Yeah.
And you were in...
I was in the hallway near the front door.
You shot him from the hallway and he shot the kitchen?
No.
Was the refrigerator somewhere else?
No, it was like... The kitchen was between me
and... who shot first?
Zero enters. She's with the pile of TVs. She stares at Big Frank, who is still staring at the TVs.
We can skip that one. And how did you come to be at the Concord Village Apartments?
I was out. I was on duty.
Did you receive a call?
Suspicious activity. I was near there, and I saw suspicious activity.
That dog barks again. It's probably pretty nearby.
The other guy's out in the car, right?
Thank you, dump truck. You didn't have any other reason to be there?
No.
Okay. Did you know Darlene filed charges against Scotty Barnes a month prior to the shooting?
Nope.
When did you start dating?
He always forgets our anniversary.
Was it before or after you shot the man she accused of assault and battery?
I dropped those charges.
I know, I'm just asking questions.
One doesn't have anything to do with the other.
I'm sure it doesn't. Your wife, your future wife, is attacked by a man you later shot when you happened to cross him breaking into an apartment.
It's a small town.
It sure is. So you shot him in the stomach and he shot the refrigerator?
He shot first.
See, there it is! I knew we'd get to the right answer eventually.
Fuck you, lady.
Frank?
Do you know what I mean when I say pattern of behavior?
The dog barks.
He shot at me. He went down. He lived. He's doing a 20-year bid. It was a good shoot.
I know. It says so right here. And I bet anyone who got their hands on this file or who decided to look into it again would come to the same conclusion. Unless They were trying to prove some sort of pattern of behavior.
Okay, I see how it kind of looks like that, but it wasn't like that.
Were you there?
Absolutely not.
Dump truck goes back to trying to light the grill.
Neither was I. And neither was anyone else, but, well, I don't have to tell you. You know how people like to start filling in the blanks.
It was a good shoot.
They really won't ask about all that.
I would.
Okay, now, I tried like 15 matches.
Let me see.
Sure.
Josie takes another photo of Frank and Dump Truck at the grill. Flash.
Sorry, the first one wasn't... Okay, much better. Was that the only time you drew your weapon?
Was that what?
The dog barks again.
The only time you... I mean, besides the recent... shooting. Obviously, besides the recent shooting.
Yeah, oh, shit, what was his name? The guy with the, okay, it was awesome. This guy had it coming.
The dog barks.
So we get a drunk and disorderly down at the old Starliner, right? And I mean, by the time we get there, Frank, what was his name? That guy with the beat-ass Trans Am.
What?
Well, by the time we get there, dude, whatever his name was, he's already out of the joint and in his car, all right? And I mean, the minute we step out of the Prowler, here comes this beat-the-shit white Trans Am headed straight for me. And I'm around the back of the car, and he damn near runs me over, right, Frank? I'm like knocked on my ass, and before I know what's what, Frank has it out, and he's just unloading on this car. Like there he is walking through the parking lot, calm as hell, putting round after round into this motherfucker.
You fired at the car?
Back tire blows and he fishtails bad, right? Okay? And he goes up on two wheels like, scree, like you might tip over, and then he's like, swoop, and he's back down on all four wheels like that right there, like, gotcha, motherfucker. I am not even joking around. It's one of the coolest things I ever saw. I got on the radio and I was like, y'all, Frankenstein just killed Trans Am.
Did you injure the man? The man in the Trans Am?
No, well, I mean little. I mean, he's more fucked up from how he crashed it. What was that dude's name?
The dog barks. Another dog barks in response.
He's fine over there.
What?
Big Frank's fine. Quit staring at him.
Yeah.
I swear to God, it's a real ass-kicker name. Kind of name that drives a white Trans Am, you know what I mean?
Was a complaint filed?
Like Jesse.
Because I didn't see in any of the paperwork anything.
No.
It was totally justified. I mean, that's clear-cut attempted right there. You had to stop that car. Bang, 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 bang!
The dogs bark at each other.
It was so badass, and that's the kind of cop you want to be. In motherfucking control.
Okay, well, I'll look into it to be sure. But those are the only times. Frank.
What?
Those are the only times you discharged your weapon. While on duty.
Yeah.
Oh, good idea. Let's get one with you and your father.
Josie sets up to take the photo. Darlene goes to Big Frank to turn around his wheelchair.
Oh, I got it.
Yeah.
Okay, let's see a smile this time, Frank.
We'll turn you back around in just a minute, Big Frank.
Yeah.
Get out of the way. Cheese.
Josie takes the photo. Flash.
You're looking the wrong way, Frankenstein.
Another photo. Flash. Josie and Darlene look at the photo.
That was great. Can I get a copy of that one?
More barking.
We should, you know what? We should get him inside.
Just put him back in front of the TVs.
You want to go inside, Dad?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You
see?
All he ever says is yeah. He needs sunshine, don't he? Can't you stay cooped up all day, can you, Big Frank?
Darlene puts Big Frank back in front of the TVs. Josie gets another file out of her bag. More barking.
The information on your time in Iraq is a little more, well, you know how the military is. And I mean, the things I've read online, I'm not sure what's true and what isn't.
What are you asking all these questions for?
For the interview.
What exactly was your job in Iraq? Is job the right word?
He was a door kicker.
Is that a term of art?
It's like it says, first through the door.
More barking.
And you saw action?
Sure.
They're going to want to talk about because of her background.
I didn't know she was fucking Iraqi.
Kuwaiti.
Barking, barking, barking.
Say fucking whatever, right?
It matters.
Bleeding heart. I didn't know. I thought she was black, all right? She was with a black kid. I thought she was a little black girl.
So, let's agree to never say that out loud in any situation.
I didn't shoot her because she was fucking black.
She wasn't black.
I shot her because I thought she was going to shoot me.
Barking, barking, barking.
Of course. And I think we can all agree that those things that you just said about her racial status, that none of us could be sure exactly what was meant by them, and therefore don't ever need to repeat what was said.
We're all in this together,
yes,
okay?
Yes. Exactly. And again, these questions, it's all about the pattern. This, then this, then this. What you did before, and how it affects what you did then, or now, or whenever. How it colors, it colors in the sense of our understanding of it, not, you know, any other sense. To put it bluntly, they're asking, could this have been avoided? Did this happen before?
I never shot any fucking kids in Iraq.
Of course not. I mean, sure, good.
You want to know if I shot people in Iraq?
Hey, man.
Well, I think we can all. I mean, the expectation
is that... Calm down,
Frank.
We're all on your side here.
Liar.
Barking, barking, barking.
It's more like if there were any unusual circumstances.
Unusual?
Or if, and I mean this sincerely, if after...
Here's how it goes. You do awful shit. Horrible shit. Shit you wouldn't wish on your worst fucking enemy, and you just keep doing it until you can't remember doing anything else until it feels normal. Do you understand? There is no unusual.
Barking, barking, barking!
Okay.
You keep going, you wake up, and you fight your way through, and you keep going because that's what somebody told you. And would somebody please shut up those motherfucking dogs?
A single bark.
Big Frank had an accident. I gotta... Frank.
You know what? I'll help you.
No.
Yes, all of this... We can do all of this later. I'll help.
Don't worry, Frank. We got it. You just stay there. What the fuck's the matter with him? Sorry.
It's fine. It's just fine.
Darlene and Josie wheel Big Frank inside through the Florida room.
No big deal, man. It's just an accident. Big Frank's got a lot of miles on him, is all. You okay? You know what? I'm gonna cook these dogs on the stove top. Grill's not charcoal, got wet, probably. Tastes better on the stove top. I think so, anyway.
Dump truck exits.
Glad you have me. I don't trust any of them.
The dog barks again. The sky starts getting dark.
They're gonna tear you apart, piece by piece. What will you look like when they put you back together?
One of the TVs turns on. On screen, we see a firework play in reverse. A constellation of sparkles sucked back into a white dot. A pop. Frank isn't sure of what he's looking at. Another firework in reverse. Another pop. He feels it.
Oh. Of course. Fireworks.
A firework plays in reverse, projected on the side of the house. A huge pop. Then the sky explodes in fireworks, all in reverse, all popping and bursting again and again. Fireworks everywhere, all backwards. Pop! After pop! After pop! Darlene opens the curtain of the Florida room and sees Frank on the ground. Darlene closes the curtain. Frank is alone with Zero, and the fireworks continue to burst. End of Act One.
Thank you.
Monsters, Act 2. Friday night, Frank is standing. Zero is sitting on the TVs like a throne.
My name was Frank Wayne. I was a monster. No one ever showed me how to be anything else. No, that's still not it, is it?
Something's wrong with me.
Yep.
I'm like broken.
I'm like broken. Now my outsides look how my insides feel. Sorry about the mess. Love, Frank. That one's pretty good. See, you're helping.
What happens when I die?
Like, do you go to hell or whatever?
Do I go anywhere?
Well, there's no heaven.
No hell either, then.
Oh, no, there's definitely a hell.
Is it worse than this?
I'm totally messing with you. For real, there's nothing.
There's something.
There's not. The universe is cold and getting colder. Everything will end in a black sky. The light will fade to nothing and nobody will be there to watch it go out.
Jesus.
I think you maybe need to just concentrate on the note. You sent me away. Why didn't you let me come back? Love, Frank.
Jesus.
But we should keep the sorry about the mess part. You sent me away. Why didn't you let me come back? Sorry about the mess. Love, Frank. Or P.S. sorry about the mess.
I can't keep listening to you. I can't keep doing this.
Yeah, I know.
There's a way out. A solution.
I think we both know this is the kind of problem that can be solved with a bullet.
Dump truck enters in uniform.
Knock, knock. You look like hammered shit.
I don't feel right.
I guess not, huh? Shit. Look, it's not like you're the one going on TV. You gotta throttle back a little.
Yeah.
Look, man, she's gonna do fine. They both will. And it ain't like this is the last time, right? They're gonna go out there and tell your side to anybody who listen, right? Right. She ready?
Yeah. No, I don't know.
She's probably more nervous than you are, huh? She probably looks better, though, huh?
Yeah.
Seriously, man, you for real sick?
I'm not sleeping great.
Okay. Probably can't go on like this, man. I mean, right? You gotta do something here.
See?
Yeah.
Darlene enters from the Florida room. She looks good. She's dressed for a TV interview where she's supposed to come across as a supportive, probably conservative, and very likely religious wife. She looks the part.
You ready?
Frank, sit.
No, he ain't. Let's go.
No, seriously, look at him. He's all fucked up a little.
Gonna be late.
Well, go with the lights on. See if he's got a fever.
You got a fever, Frank?
No.
See, he's fine. He's just against the interview. He's been dragging his goddamn feet all week because he's too stupid to know, and people are trying to help his dumb ass.
Darlene goes back inside.
She loves you, man. She just, you know, she ain't really a nurturer. So if you needed a nurturer, why'd you marry a stripper, right?
Have you ever...
What's that?
Have you ever? This is so fucking stupid.
It's cool, man. That's whatever.
You ever see stuff? I mean, think that you saw something, but you didn't see something. You didn't see it, but you did.
Careful, Frankenstein.
Like what?
Like anything.
Look, man, I bet it did look like she had a gun. And even if it was nothing at all, that move, right? That reach down to the waistband turn, we are trained, and this here's the truth, we are trained to respond to that, okay? That move gets a goddamn rex out of anybody in blue. I don't care who you are, goddamn pacifist or hard-charging prick. You do bad stuff, you pay the consequences, that's a trade-off. That's what you're talking about, right? You thought she had...
No. Yeah. No. Yeah.
Whatever you thought you saw, you saw. Shit, man. I mean, what they want, right? Fucking perfection? That ain't gonna happen, man. We do our best, we clock out, we go home. You don't like it? Well, try living in a world without cops for 15 minutes, see how far you get, am I right?
Darlene comes back out.
Okay, let's go.
You ready?
I said I was, didn't I?
Well,
Darlene exits through the gate.
We'll see you, Frank. Hang in there, man. Just I don't know. Keep your head down. Don't do anything. We got you. Feel better.
Dump truck exits.
Okay, get your gun.
Frank gets his gun out of the red cooler.
I feel really close to you right now. It's nice. We gotta write out the note first, though, okay, Frank? Don't just sit there. I still see you, Frank. You can't hide.
Leave me alone.
You're shivering again.
I'm not gonna kill myself.
You scared?
Did you hear me?
I like you scared. Makes me think you might do something drastic.
Go away.
It should be tonight. Doesn't it feel like it should be tonight? We should do it tonight.
I'm not scared of you.
Yeah, I know. I'm afraid of myself now, and the only thing I know how to do is kill the things I'm afraid of. Love, Frank.
We're not doing that anymore.
P.S. Sorry about the mess.
I'm not writing any fucking note.
Sure you are. It's not for you, it's for them. Like, it's polite. Just ask my dad. The last thing I said to him was, you're so unfair, and then I snuck out anyways.
They're trying to help me.
Who is?
Darlene, Ray.
You think so?
They got me. They got my back.
Okay. What's that?
What's what?
That.
The vertical blinds to the Florida room slide open, but the Florida room is gone. It's a hotel room now. Behind the glass doors, we see dump truck on the bed in uniform. Darlene is stripping out of the outfit we just saw her in. Dump truck watches.
Well, this seems suspicious, huh?
What is that?
You tell me.
Stop it.
I'm not in the room. What can I do about it?
Stop it right now.
I'm not doing anything. Can you see okay from where you are? You don't want to miss this.
This isn't happening. The interview.
One of the TVs turns on. We see Josie on the screen. She is being interviewed.
I think we can all agree Officer Wayne tried to do the right thing in the wrong place at the wrong time.
Wait. No, that's not. They're supposed to be.
Another TV turns on. It's the same feed of Josie.
I think it's our responsibility to ask, what are the situational characteristics, and what are the individual characteristics of the officer and the citizen involved in the incident?
Where's Darlene?
Right there. Seriously, can you see okay from where you are?
A few more of the TVs come on.
What a situation seems to be on the surface isn't necessarily what it is when you start to strip things away.
This isn't real.
Look at him. He's like, no, 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 we shouldn't. Even though you can totally tell he doesn't mean it, he's still, like, making the effort to say it. He's a good friend.
No.
Darlene, though, I mean, no hesitation. She knew before they got there. Look at her. She knew days ago. When do you think she decided to fuck your friend?
Stop.
Don't get mad at me. She's the one who planned this. I bet she shaved your pussy and everything.
Frank aims the gun at Zero. A second Josie appears on the TVs, out of sync with the first set.
The question I want to ask is, why isn't anyone asking what did the perpetrator do to force Officer Wayne to use force?
Stop this. Now.
I think I'm one of those problems a bullet can't solve, you know what I mean?
Darlene dances. She strips. Under the conservative outfit is exactly the sort of thing you'd expect a private dancer to wear to a hotel room party. The two separate interviews of Josie start to overlap.
We have to assign personal responsibility here. Her actions led directly to this outcome. She is the cause of this unfortunate situation. Without her, what happens? Choices were made before Officer Wayne entered the picture. She is a criminal who was engaged in a criminal act. No one is disputing that. Without her, Officer Wayne ends his shift peacefully and goes home to his wife. Without her, Officer Wayne doesn't even draw his gun.
Does she fuck all of her clients?
She does. She's a dancer.
Just the people you're close to?
No.
You're right. This is probably some kind of misunderstanding.
Safira Zell is as responsible for her own death as Officer Wayne was. Of course he bears some responsibility.
Have you seen that lingerie before? That's the kind of lingerie you wear when you know somebody's gonna see it, huh?
And so do we.
Is it because you can't freaking get it up? Because you shot a kid? Is that the deal? Or was there trouble before that? When's the last time you guys did it?
I don't want to engage in victim blaming.
I swear to God.
She's looking out for herself, right?
Accident is too small a word for what happened, but it is literally the case. This was an accident. This only happened once. This would never happen again, or on a different day, or under different conditions. A perfect storm of circumstance.
She learned a lesson from you, huh, Frank? Shoot first. Frank would want this, she says. We have an understanding, she says. And what can he say to that?
Better to say nothing, he thinks, and then he's glad he didn't because the bra comes off. He wants to be you so bad he can taste it.
Darlene's bra comes off. She gets on her knees in front of dump truck. We see her from behind. We see dump truck's face.
Stop.
No.
Yes.
Can I ask a question? Isn't this exactly what we asked him to do? Well, he doesn't seem to have any problem getting it up, huh? Does that always work?
Darlene lowers her head into dump truck's lap. Zero touches Frank's gun.
Didn't we ask him to protect us? This isn't the one that got me, is it? I like it, though.
Don't.
Do you like that, she says? Is this what you wanted, she says? He doesn't have to answer, she knows. And in that way, all parties are responsible for what happened. Why can I touch you? Can we judge them for that? Is that fair? My blood got in your mouth after you picked me up. How could we have protected against it? Something got mixed up. Maybe. I guess that makes sense. Do we have to fear everyone? Who could be closer than us? We are the reason Officer Wayne was in that parking lot that night. If you're not comfortable with this, you can pretend I'm her. Do you think that he's pretending to be you?
Darlene stands up. Darlene and dump truck are getting into bed together. The blinds to the Florida room start to close.
Oh. Wait.
If he's going to jail, we should too. Show's over.
Bring them back.
You think it's his fault or hers? We can't defend ourselves from accidents, from circumstance. We can't protect against the things that already happened. All we can do is move on.
Open the blinds.
Pervert, you know how it's gonna end.
God damn it.
You're all alone.
It's not real. It's you.
No.
You're doing it.
My pleasure.
Leave me alone.
Oh, thank you for having me. Thank you for having me.
Leave me alone!
You're shooting at the wrong person, Frankenstein.
Bang, bang, bang! Frank fires at Zero. Nothing. The TVs flicker off. It's dark. Zero and Frank are alone. Later that night, Frank in handcuffs. Police lights in the driveway. Zero is at the fence, looking out at the commotion next door.
Oh, there's another one! Another one just pulled up in front of the neighbor's house.
You don't have to tell me every time a cop car shows up.
This is exciting.
Dump truck comes out of the house in uniform. He's carrying two rifles.
What are you doing with those?
They're coming with me and a nine.
You can't have those.
The fuck I can't? Well, let's start over. How about you answer my questions honestly this time, or I take your fucking guns. How about that? What were you shooting at?
Nothing.
Nothing.
Your neighbor's in the front yard now.
You just decided to, out of the fucking goddamn blue, to pop off a couple of rounds in the middle of your fucking neighborhood.
He's crying pretty hard.
And you just happened to fire in the direction of your neighbor's house, and you just happened to shoot their goddamn dog.
Is he gonna make it?
How am I supposed to fucking answer that, Frank?
Oh, there he is. They've got him, like, on a little stretcher.
I wasn't aiming at the dog.
Yeah? You won't tell me who you were aiming at?
Nobody.
Why are you lying to me? The girl's dad brings a fucking gun into your backyard, threatens your life a couple of days later. Here the fuck we are back in your backyard, shots fired, and you're saying one thing ain't got nothing to do with the other.
It was an accident.
Did you hit him too? Frank, I know don't miss. I'm saying, am I getting another call tonight because a grieving father's bleeding to death on his way home?
He wasn't here.
And you're sticking with that? I don't know what the fuck you're looking at me like that for, man. I'm trying to, you know, like, clean this thing up, and you're giving me the goddamn Manson lamps like I don't know what's what. Well, I fucking know what's what, man. You fucked up for real. Any other fucking night be fine, but tonight, why they're on TV? You see how that's like maybe not the best time to pull this shit? You get why this is bad, right?
Take off the handcuffs.
Captain's out there with dotting I's and crossing T's for real. Everybody's watching now.
It was an accident.
You understand we got like no time at all to come up with something that flies here, right? You say it wasn't her dad, fine. Fuck you, I don't believe you, but fine. Was it somebody else?
No.
Sit back down, Frank. Frank, sit down.
You're really being cool about this. I mean it for real. You're like a way better friend than he deserves.
Dump truck's radio goes off.
Stand by the cop.
I would be, like, insane with jealousy or whatever.
It didn't happen.
10-6. What?
Nothing.
Ask him if he was at a motel. Ask him.
No.
What?
Ask him if he was at a motel.
I'm not asking.
What the fuck are you saying?
Ask him.
Were you at a motel?
10-6 at the scene. Did you get it in Darlene's medicine cabinet or something?
Okay.
Don't fuck around with that shit, man. You can't handle it.
The radio goes off again.
I said 10-6. Goddamn.
I understand. Your relationship with Darlene is your business. You know what she's like. And you know, like, so what that he's your best friend?
Where you going? You ain't going nowhere. Now why you act like you don't want my help?
Darlene enters. She is as pissed as she has ever been.
Whoa!
Fucking asshole!
All right, now, let's not...
Darlene takes off her shoes and throws them at Frank. Dump truck restrains Darlene.
It was an accident.
Calm down!
You shot the neighbor's fucking dog? What is the matter with you?
Oh, well, hey,
you gotta kill everything? I can't even look at you.
Look at me.
Fuck
hey,
you, Frank.
Hey, look at me. You ain't got no time for this. You got, like, no time at all before the news gets here, right? And you don't want to be here when that happens, right? You're just gonna get your shit and go, okay? Okay? Yeah? All right, go on. One bag, for real.
Darlene goes inside the house.
Yeah, there's definitely not anything going on there.
Darlene!
No, we ain't doing that.
Get your hands off me.
Look, man, I'm on your side here, all right?
Sure. What about her?
There you go, that's more like it.
Frank, you had enough shit go down tonight, right? You don't need a domestic on top of it. Just calm down.
Where are you taking her?
I'm not taking her anywhere. She's going...
You the one that called her? Told her what happened?
No, she fucking found out as soon as I did. We were standing right next to each other. It's already on the news. No way we...
You were with her?
Yeah. At the TV station. I took her down there. You saw me pick her up. Shit, man, are you okay?
Didn't stop nowhere first?
For real, did you get in Darlene's pills?
You didn't stop by the motel?
What fucking motel you talking about?
Come here.
What?
Come here.
What is it?
Frank headbutts dump truck.
Shit! Fuck! What the fuck you do that for?
Dump truck gushes blood. Frank jumps on top of dump truck. They sort of wrestle around even though Frank is handcuffed.
Get the fuck off me, man! What is wrong with you? Stop it, Frank! Stop it!
Dump truck gets away from Frank. Frank scrambles to his knees. He's a bull ready to charge.
Tell me she didn't suck your dick.
What?
Tell me she didn't suck your dick!
You gotta calm down, Frank. You got 15 cops and 2 news crews at the end of your...
Frank comes at dump truck again. It's sort of a tackle. Dump truck gets his baton loose. Dump truck hits Frank in the back. It's brutal, but Frank keeps coming. Frank knocks dump truck over. They're on the ground again. Dump truck loses his baton. He is struggling.
Tell me she didn't suck your dick. Tell me she didn't suck your dick.
Dump truck manages to kick Frank away and gets his pepper spray from his belt. Dump truck sprays Frank in the face. Frank recoils. Dump truck picks up the baton and hits Frank in the back of the knees. Frank falls to the ground but keeps moving. Dump truck hits him a couple of times with the baton.
What the fuck is wrong with you? Stay down! Stay down, Frank! Fucking roll over. Hump your stomach, goddammit! I said fucking roll over!
Frank finally rolls over. Dump truck is on him. His knee is in Frank's back, holding him down.
What you wanna do here, huh? You wanna go out front, get your ass kicked on 10 o'clock news, you ungrateful piece of shit? You know what I'm trying to do for you? Do you? Answer me!
I saw it! Fucking saw it! Let go of me!
You are making it awful hard for me to be your friend right now, Frank.
You ain't my fucking friend.
I'm not? Huh? You don't wanna be my friend? You have any idea what I put on the line for you?
Fuck you.
Fuck me. Get up, motherfucker. Get out of the car. I'm gonna crack your fucking head up in your fucking backyard. Get up!
Both men stand. Separate. It's about to get worse. Darlene enters from the house carrying a bag stuffed with clothes.
Jesus Christ, are you okay?
Get on out of here.
You did this?
I'm fine, baby. Thanks for checking on me.
What the fuck is wrong with you?
I love you too, baby.
Why have you got to fuck everything up?
All right, man.
Let go of me. You know what it was like for me tonight? I'm on TV defending your dumb ass, and then you go killing dogs and fighting cops in our backyard, turning me into a liar on motherfucking national fucking television?
You don't need any help from me, baby.
What'd you say? You want everything to fall apart, huh? Crumble in your rotten fucking hands? You fucking do it on your own, Frankenstein.
Come on now.
You try that for a little while and you see how far you get. God damn it, I said leave me alone.
You gotta get on out of here right now.
You fucking did it, didn't you? Say it didn't happen. Tell me, go on.
You fucked up, you hear me? You need to get your head right.
Tell me it didn't happen. Tell me, motherfucker. Tell me she didn't suck your dick. Tell me, man. Fucking tell me. Tell me. Tell me. Tell me.
What? She sucked my dick. Jesus Christ, Frank. She sucked everything. wipe me off. Look. You are a motherfucker. You know that. Are we done? Or do you want to go to jail tonight?
Dump truck shows the keys to Frank. He's offering to unlock the cuffs. Frank nods and turns around. Dump truck undoes the cuffs. Dump truck quickly moves away from Frank.
She's your problem now, huh? It's what you want, isn't it? This goddamn dream come true.
Why do you keep pushing me, man? You really won't go through this alone.
You want to be me, huh? You want to be me, motherfucker? Try it sometime. You can't handle this. You can't be me.
Who the fuck would want to be you?
Dump truck collects the guns and exits. Frank is left alone with Zero. She moves closer to him, checks his injuries. The cordless phone rings. Frank answers it.
Hello? Yeah. Yeah, well, come on over. Tonight's as good a night as any. I'm all alone.
Frank hangs up, drops the phone.
You're not going anywhere, are you?
No.
Okay.
Frank sits and waits. The next day, daytime, Frank kneels next to the kiddie pool. His head and shoulders are submerged in the water. Zero is looking out over the fence into the street. Frank whips his head out of the water, takes a breath. He goes back under.
Drowning doesn't seem like you.
Frank comes back out of the water.
Hanging, maybe. I mean, bullet to the head, number one for sure, but, like, number two, hanging in the basement or the garage or whatever.
I'm not trying to drown myself. Still trying to get that shit out of my eyes. Clear my fucking head.
I bet it's not working.
Yeah, no. You still out there?
Why did he drive all the way over here if he was just going to sit in the car all night? I sort of can't even see him anymore. Maybe he's lying down.
Frank goes through the cans, finds a full beer, opens it.
No. Well, I think it was Basra. I'm remembering that wrong. Ray could tell you, he always knew where we were. I always thought everything over there looked like everything else, but, you know, Ray could always tell the difference. So, not like you know where I'm talking about. It's Highway 8. We're on Highway 8, and there's all these, I mean, they're abandoned cars kind of all up and down the highway, burned like a while ago. Some kind of horror show parking lot, right? For miles. All of a sudden, there's a pop. You know, we all go, what the fuck was that? And we're all like, it was gunfire, right? Yeah, but okay, is there going to be more, you know? Because it was only one shot. I'm not even sure it was a shot. It was whatever it was. And the sergeant, he's like, as you know, he's the guy in charge, okay? He's like the boss. He turns and fires at the spot he thinks the pop came from. So then it's on. We all turn. But I don't even get my gun up. I'm looking at the sergeant because he's screaming and like pounding on his rifle, okay? So it's jammed. And he's like, wham, wham, wham! And he brings it right back up, cheek to stock, pulls the trigger. Well, the whole fucking thing just blows up right there. Neck and jaw gone like that. Fucking thing was overcharged. They didn't. Blew the bottom of his face just fucking off. I mean, okay, he's dead. I mean, not dead yet, right away, but. So we all stopped because nobody's firing back at us. And the sergeant was bleeding to death right there on the fucking asphalt. And we're all looking at each other like, what the fuck are we supposed to do now? Because, okay, there's no fixing this. Most of his jaw's gone. He's moving, gagging. He's trying to talk. There's no words coming out. Like, he's trying to give orders or something, but instead he's just choking on blood and gun parts, and all of a sudden it hits me. Somebody needs to fucking take over. Somebody needs to take charge of this fucking situation, and I will be goddamn if it's gonna be me, because what the fuck? I'm not kidding. All of a sudden, I'm freezing cold all over. I mean, like, scared. Like a kid or something. So I don't say shit. And I guess every single one of us feels the exact same way, because nobody says shit. We just watch it. No one takes charge. It's not like the movies where, okay, the guy goes down and, like, the next guy in line starts shouting orders over the explosions. We're just left there for a minute. Some kind of fucking war hang time. He's bleeding all over the asphalt. I mean, it's everywhere.
takes a minute, okay? I mean, you know, but all bleeding stops eventually. You should have cleaned the fucking thing. All that sand, I mean, you know, it gets everywhere. It's sand. It's just everywhere. I mean, that's all there is. I'm sorry. I don't know what made me.
I wanted you to tell me a story about Kuwait.
I don't know any stories about Kuwait. Honestly, I was only in Kuwait for a couple of days. All I remember is it was on fire.
Well, you could tell me anything about it, and I wouldn't know the difference. I only remember it from pictures.
Yeah, but it's not... I mean, that's not so bad, okay? You would have died over there. It's not really a safe place for kids.
Frank goes back into the water.
Guests!
Darlene enters from the driveway, followed by Josie. Frank comes back out of the pool.
What the fuck are you doing in the pool?
Let's not.
Well, what's he doing?
Let's say what we came to say.
Hey.
Jesus, Frank, are you drunk right now?
Darlene.
Frank, I think maybe before you say anything, you should let Darlene say what needs to be said. Don't you? Don't you think you owe her that after what you put her through last night? Isn't that the least you can give her? Because I think, and I'm sorry if I'm out of line, but I couldn't live with myself if I didn't say it. I think you owe her a great deal more than just having her say, but as her lawyer, I think I'd advise her, insofar as what she can get from you is concerned, that she should aim low.
What's going on?
Soaking fucking wet.
Darlene, it has to be today.
Well, I don't know where to start, man.
I have some difficult news to share with you. Darlene, I have some difficult news to share with you.
Frank, I have some difficult news to share with you.
We cannot continue in this way.
Yeah, I know. Frank, we cannot continue in this way.
What? Wait. What?
What happened last night was...
It was an accident.
Why are you even saying that? Don't nobody believe that. No one believes
Let's
that.
We're not here to talk about the incident with the firearm in specific, although that was a catalyst. It got the ball rolling.
It was an accident.
Frank, I think you know both Darlene and I witnessed you threatening that dog on the 4th of July.
Are you? Why the fuck is she here?
She's my lawyer, Frank.
Why do you need a lawyer to talk to your husband?
Seriously? Do you not see what's going on here?
It's an ambush.
Look, I know you're mad about last night.
You murdered the neighbor's dog.
Your limit. You've reached your limit.
I've reached my limit.
What does that mean?
There's like a line, Frank, and I'm past it.
What line?
I don't know, Frank, like a regular line, like a circle, and you just kept pushing until I was on the outside and you were all alone in the middle.
For Christ's sake, I did not push.
I am at risk here. You've put me at risk here, and I can't do that no more. Can't do that anymore.
I don't even know what you're saying right now.
She's talking about leaving you.
You're talking about leaving me?
Yes.
Yes.
That's why she's here.
I refuse to defend myself against you. I've been hurt enough.
Oh, you have, huh?
I need to let somebody else defend me. I need to stay safe.
You're not safe with me.
Your violent nature is putting me at risk.
I would never hurt you.
There are other ways to be put at risk.
What are you talking about?
Last night's incident. Your failure to disclose the threats from the dead girl's father. Your marital failures.
My what?
Alienation of affection. That's not very safe, is it?
Wait, what?
I gotta protect myself. I feel like you're gonna hurt me.
I wouldn't hurt you, even if I wanted to hurt you.
That's a threat. I was a witness to that threat.
It wasn't a threat.
Then I hope you endeavor to choose your words more carefully.
Fuck. You. Bitch.
Frank, your hostile reaction to this situation is understandable because it's what we've come to expect from you. Do you understand that?
I don't want to talk to you.
You're conforming to a narrative.
You're leaving me because I fired my gun in the backyard.
And because you murdered a dog while I was on TV saying you weren't no violent fucking maniac. Wasn't no violent fucking maniac.
Okay, that's... Okay. You're talking to me now. You're done talking to Darlene. Or more precisely, she's done talking to you. For the time being, she can't hear you right now.
She's standing right there.
You're behaving the way a violent person would. The way way a person predisposed to violence would behave. The kind of person that would react violently, even if the situation did not warrant
Darlene,
it.
Darlene.
You can't hear him.
Can't hear you.
I know you can hear me. You're like 10 feet away.
You solve your problems the same way, over and over again. Sort of a compulsion, except you choose to do it, even when you know it's wrong. And that makes everyone think you're going to do it again.
Look, what? Why are you... You said you were going
to
help me.
Point of order, I said I was going to help Darlene.
You said...
I was in a different position then. The optics have changed dramatically.
You said you were going to help. You fucking told me. God damn it, you fucking said.
That was when you were a hero. Now we're someplace else. We can all agree on that, right? There's an awful lot of swing in the American consciousness, and the trick is being on the right side of it. V is for victory, and we all support the troops. We support the troops, but not the war. We support... War, it's a crime, and you're a baby killer. It's a spectrum, a range.
Darlene, can we please get outside of here and talk?
You are the one that fucked this all up.
It was an accident!
I'm not talking about the dog. I'm talking about the fucking girl. And you drowning in your fucking depression or guilt or whatever the fuck's got a hold of you.
Of course I'm guilty. I'm supposed to be guilty.
Why?
I shot a little girl.
So fucking what? You can't make me give a fuck about her. You know how many people die every year? I looked it up on the fucking internet. 2 million.
Darlene.
What the fuck makes her so goddamn important? Who the fuck is she? She ain't shit to me. I care about me. I'm supposed to care about me. I am first on my motherfucking list, motherfucker, and that is how it is supposed to be. That is the world we live in, and I don't know where the fuck you're at.
All right, that's all very colorful.
I'll not have you drag me down with you, okay? I do not want to go where the fuck it is that you're
going.
All right,
let's just...
Fuck you, Plank. Fuck you for making me walk out on you. I'm a good person. I'm a good person. You got me into this.
Into what?
Okay. I'm going to tell you a story. A girl was in trouble with a bad guy, so she went to an even worse guy for help. I think you can guess how it turned out.
You talking about Scotty?
Starters.
You broke your fucking nose in two places. You forget about that?
The part I remember is how you were on the phone breathing fast and telling me how we got to get our story straight. That's the part I remember.
That's what you wanted. That's what you fucking asked for. Now you're pissed that I gave you what you wanted.
She's not mad at you. She's done with you.
The things about you that used to be good for me are bad for me now, okay?
I'm the bad guy.
You're the even worse guy.
This is your fault.
Frank, America doesn't forgive. It forgets. We get so distracted by our next meal, we forget to keep an eye on what we're eating. And I think it's time to let that natural process begin.
I don't want forgiveness.
Good, then we understand each other.
You're just done with me.
You bring violence with you wherever you go. And Darlene needs safety. I just don't think she can safely be around a person like you. I don't think anybody can.
Because I'm dangerous.
Exactly.
I'm a monster.
Yes.
You're right. There's no place for me. Guys like me should be put down. But you'd need a guy like me to put a guy like me down, so you're probably fucked on that front, huh?
I understand you're angry.
Lady... I'm as fucking dangerous as you say I am. Why are you standing so close?
Josie steps back.
And now, I'll have to inform the police that I've been threatened too.
You're the monster.
I don't think you're seeing things very clearly right now.
Get the fuck out of here.
I don't recommend staying here alone with
you. I meant both of you. The fuck out of here.
Right. Josie takes Darlene's hand. They exit.
Good that they're gone. It should be just us when we do it.
I'm all alone.
You're not. You have me. We'll disappear together. That feels like a happy ending.
You're the reason this is all fucked up.
Eventually, everybody blames the victim. I think that is so weird.
How am I supposed to know what I was thinking? I don't know what happened before I shot you.
I don't either. I think I remember being in your arms.
I don't remember. I don't know if I thought you had a gun or not.
I think death is probably just hard to remember.
I just reacted. The training takes over.
I don't care why you did it. I don't think anybody cares why you did it. They pretend like they do, but it's so they can keep you away. It's just easier to let you be a monster. If you're a monster, all they have to do is be on the lookout for monsters.
It's not like I wanted to do it.
Monsters aren't even what you should be looking out for. It's the stuff that fades into the background. Take for granted. Most things feel safe as long as you don't look too closely.
was an accident.
Just because it was an accident doesn't mean you aren't responsible for what you did. And you know what you did, right?
I crossed the line.
You crossed the line. And there's no going back. So, let's be done. What are you afraid of?
Zell enters. He is carrying a gun.
You're late.
I was out. I was in the car. I saw your wife.
She's gone.
You said you were alone.
I'm alone.
Okay. Okay, then.
Anywhere you like.
I don't want to do this.
Yes, you do. You're going to have to get a little closer, okay?
We're made how we're made. I'm the father of a dead girl. You're her killer. And he brought us both to this spot. Now. I know what I have to do.
Let's get it over with.
I have to forgive you.
What?
I have to forgive you. He wants me to forgive you.
No.
He's right.
No.
Here.
Zell tries to give Frank the gun.
Why are you giving me that? Don't give me that.
Take it.
Stop it.
I don't forgive you. She won't rest.
No.
She'll stay there, frozen in that parking lot, bleeding to death over and over again.
Nope.
Never moving on. Never going home.
No, I killed your daughter.
I know. And I have to let her go.
What is wrong with you?
I have to do this.
How the fuck can you forgive me? What kind of person are you that... I shot your fucking daughter, you asshole.
I know. I don't want to do this. This is what he wants. This is what she wants.
No.
She would want me to forgive you.
She was still alive when I got to her. She was drowning in blood, but she was still alive.
That must be how you wanted it.
She said, Dad.
Don't tell him that.
He was quiet. There wasn't much left, but she was asking for you, and you weren't there.
That's not true.
There are no accidents.
I was there. It took a little while for her to die.
No one dies in a way that's not his choosing.
She wants me dead. She doesn't want you to forgive me. She told me. Listen to me. She told me. She comes to me. I see her.
So do I. They say nothing can bring her back, but that's not true. Everything brings her back. Everything. I have to let her be dead.
No.
Give you.
No!
Frank punches Zell in the face. The gun falls away somewhere in the backyard. Frank proceeds to beat the ever-living shit out of Zell.
You do not get to forgive me. Why would you even say that?
Frank is tossing him around. Kicks, punches, brutal, just taking him apart.
Look at me. I'm a monster.
Frank grabs his arms. Frank hits Zell with his own hands.
She's buried in the ground, and I get to be out here. Does that seem fair to you?
Frank is using Zell's hands to hit himself now.
Come on, hit me! Come on, kick my fucking ass! I killed your little girl. What are you waiting for?
Frank lets go of Zell.
Come on, man. Look what I did. There is no undoing that. I can't ever go back, okay? You go too far, you don't ever get to come home. Look at what I did! I pointed a gun at your little girl. And she was on the fucking ground before I thought twice about it. It wasn't until after
Frank
that...
Frank finds the gun.
Don't.
Frank puts it in Zell's hands.
Take it.
No.
Please. I didn't even say I was sorry. I would do it again. I would. I know I would. Look at me. I'm guilty. I did it. I killed your daughter.
I know.
Frank holds the gun under his chin.
Here. I'll hold it for you. All you have to do is pull the trigger. It's the easiest thing in the world. No one will blame you. Everyone will understand. Please.
Let go.
You'll understand that. You'll be a hero.
No.
Frank moves the gun to his forehead.
Do it. Please. Please just do it. I deserve it. You know I deserve it. Please. You have to do it. I can't do it. You have to. No. No, goddammit, stop. Please. You can't leave us here. Don't leave. Please don't. Please don't leave me here.
going anywhere.
No.
No. I'm not done with you yet.
End of play.
Vocabulary and the pattern and the way that he talked, that I know those people, I've heard those people. And obviously Nate has too.
Yeah. I'm afraid I just have to say I'm still just overjoyed by the absolute fabulous actors that we have. And how they all, who I've known and seen in many beautifully done.
Yeah, no, we have a great resource here in Nashville and the talent world, so I'm glad you appreciate it.
I do, you know I do.
Yes, sir.
What really struck me was the mention. This particular story, even though it's happening in this particular place, it's repeating itself, say, in the Northeast in some families, in the Pacific Northwest in some families. So I really appreciate the fact that this story captured something that's probably a universal truth happening in the lives of many families. And I really appreciate the fact that they brought that to life and both made it real.
Thank you. Good comment. What else? Yes.
I think this is a cool thing, but at one point through most of the play, I disliked everyone that I was watching.
At some point?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Like, I really didn't want to see them anymore because they were making me aggravated. But I think that's a cool thing.
I'd love for someone to... Oh, go ahead.
So in real life, this person, dump truck, right, would be someone that I would, like, stay very far away from. But that moment when he's like, "You don't want to be my friend, Frank." I was like, moved. Yeah. I like felt very conflicted by that.
I'd love someone to talk about Frank. How you feel about him? What do we know? What do you know about him? Did you have any trouble discerning what his story was? How did you receive your idea about him? And any responses you might have to that? Yeah.
I liked how Frank's character started very internal.
Yeah.
And as the play progresses, you move along with him. I feel like his was the character that most revealed itself.
Okay, good.
Throughout the play. And that was very, that definitely carried me through. And my passion for the play grew with his passion towards the other character.
Thank you for that. What else? Oh, wait a minute.
I like that he was both more and less sympathetic than I expected. You know, so like I kept trying to put him in a caricature. I was like, oh, well, he's never done anything like this before. Oh, well, wait, he really has. Now how do I feel? You know, so, and he didn't always do what you want. You know, you thought, okay, well, he's going to come around. He's going to do the right thing. And he does, and he does. You know, so I liked that every time I thought, I was like, okay, now this is how I'm supposed to feel about him. I changed a little bit.
Thank you for that. Yeah, what were you going to say?
I was just thinking that from the moment he started talking, I felt that he was doomed.
Really? You got that sense?
Yeah, a lot of times, you know, play will write a character who's in a desperate situation, and then it seems like, oh, he might get out of it, and it's like, oh, no, I didn't get out of it. But there was that little bit of hope. I never felt any hope for Frank.
Really?
And I felt bad, because, like, man, you're just doing everything wrong. and not that he could have done anything right.
Yeah.
But it was kind of like watching No Exit, the soccer play, where you're just like, these guys are going to be here,
like,
forever.
Yeah, you're screwed. Yeah.
And you're just so screwed now. Like, sorry about that, Frank. They're all trying to help you, but...
Yeah? Okay, that's really helpful. Good. Yes?
At the very beginning, I felt that Frank felt bad for what he had done. As the play moved on, I felt like maybe he felt bad because he didn't feel bad, and it took zero to make him feel bad for what happened. As at the end, he starts saying, well, I did this, and I had to do this, and we were trained for this, and I don't know, I just got that sense that reason why he felt that changed.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Well, you know, recently there's been so much in the media, but, you know, with the shootings and harshness and everything, so for me, Frank, you know, he did more for me, but I have great sympathy for him just because I am personally know someone whose husband came back and they almost divorced because of what and then the most telling thing is when Frank's there's some line about they're training us to do this,
right?
And then we come back and we're supposed to behave normally. And so I think it's totally, for me, was totally understandable.
You felt that. Thank you. Yes.
Frank to me reminded me of one of those friends that you defend and defend because you want to see the good in them until they finally push you so far away that you can't defend them anymore.
Huh.
And it comes back to that line Darlene said to him, the things about you that used to be good for me are now bad for me. And that's how Frank plays to me, that line really landed with me. They finally all got to the point where they were like, we just can't.
told me to say that line slowly. She said, that's an important line. Don't run over that. So I tried.
That was the entirety of my direction.
Exactly.
That was
it.
Yes, down here.
I just have a lot of trouble. Why are we putting guys like Frank in this situation?
Yeah.
In our world. Gun violence is what we're talking about here. And that's pretty sobering. We can laugh about it, and it's beautiful. This play was beautiful. But I hope this raises some awareness, and we shouldn't be putting guys like Frank in that position.
Anybody else want to bounce off that?
For me, it was kind of
hard. Oh, it's heavy.
Yeah? No. I'm ready to pick a fight. I mean, no, really, Frank is, you can sympathize with him, and yet... Killed a girl because she was brown. Did he?
Yeah.
Is that how you perceived it?
No. I shoplifted. I don't know if any of you guys did, but sure didn't get my hair blown off.
Say what?
I said, I shoplifted. I don't know about you guys, but it was in a world where I could get my head blown off then.
Yeah.
It is now.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
It's about gun violence, but I also thought it was about PTSD.
Yeah.
And we're not taking care of our people.
No,
and
without a doubt. Without a doubt.
But all of that was because he was ruined in the war, and yeah, he keeps doing stupid, violent things because.
And don't you think it was also about this girl who was doing something bad? We can't excuse her. She was doing something bad, and he was the security guard. They are not supposed to do their job. Why wasn't she hiding her father? Obviously, you get the innuendo here that she didn't like her father.
Yeah.
But she's not haunting him, she's haunting Frank.
Uh-huh.
Because Frank's about to save her.
He said she was.
And he said he would do it again.
I keep thinking that it's important to see that all this is going on in Frank's mind.
Yeah.
That zero only exists in his mind. And I think, and a corollary to that, Dr. is important, is that we need to see that the thing between dump truck and life is also in his mind.
Mm-hmm.
That he's not being victimized by them.
Mm-hmm. Did anybody else have a feeling about a zero that you'd like to express at all? In his mind, not in his mind? Does it matter? And where do you come down on that?
Well, I don't know if I should admit this, but I was not drawn into the implications about our responsibilities and as many other people were, and the war and violence and all of that. It was very much for me about Frank and his resistance. seems such a universal thing to me that that's what we do, is try to resist our own pain, not be there, and that it's the only thing that can offer us redemption. And I don't know if this was directed on purpose into the end of the play, but for me, at the end of the play, I saw, wow, he's going to sit with his pain, and he might even be okay in some way because of that. That somehow being unable to in any way resist now going into his pain, that there might be redemption for him. That was what that last moment was for me.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thinking, Nero and Frank, there was a point in the play when she kept asking him, what did he do in our Kuwait? And I was going to think, well, maybe he fathered her.
Oh, really?
Because, I mean,
I thought that too.
Today, you know, within 20 years, I mean, they don't know exactly when the play was, but it wouldn't have surprised me to see that. I think it's been a little cliche, but it's almost like a love. She could have been mine or something.
So you felt some kinship,
right,
even if it's just on a spiritual level, but of some kind that led you down that path. Yeah. Yes,
sir. Regarding Zero, I just want to say that when the play ended, going back to what I felt sad.
Yeah.
I felt so sad for Zero. I just felt for her so much by the end of the play, that everything she had gone through, and it was, I don't know, I felt like, was trying to keep her, Zell brought her here to keep her safe, and nothing could keep her safe, and she still ended up getting killed. So I just felt like, whole pair of jeans, she didn't deserve this, and it was just heartbreaking.
Yeah.
It was kind of like the meeting with two zeros. He didn't deserve it. She didn't deserve this.
Yeah.
He didn't deserve
this. Does anybody have, go ahead, John.
I may have heard it wrong, but my feelings about Frank changed towards the end when, am I correct that he shot the guy on purpose?
Scotty Barnes, you mean?
Scotty?
Yeah.
Scotty.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's
when I learned that, I was, because I was
told him to tell him to do it. That's amazing.
Yeah.
He totally told him to do it.
So, I was happy at the end when he didn't die because he got to stay and pay some consequences.
Pay the consequences? Okay.
Because until that point, I was, felt like he was just a product of his, war and all that kind of stuff. But when he did that, that was a premeditated thing, and he had a chance to think about that and not do it.
So that made a difference for you in your perception?
Yeah, maybe I'm a bastard one, something a little bit. But
are you raising a hand?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm raising a hand. Sorry, honey. I just think it's interesting, going off his point, that the one time that he technically, by training, used his firearm correctly, because he saw her move in a way that encouraged him to shoot, is the time that he gets in trouble. And the previous times when he had used his firearm technically uncalled for or incorrectly, he gets by.
Huh.
And it's like it opens the door to him getting in trouble.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting. Does anybody have a response that you'd like to share, that you'd be willing to share about Zell? How did that land on you? Just kind of a gut feeling about his story, his response to the situation. I mean, did you have any thoughts about that at all?
The only thing I want to say is I looked at the father and daughter. Honestly, I mean, I understand she was the one who got killed and blah, 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 but I didn't see her as that. I saw her symbolic as actually the devil. I mean, I saw that symbolism of her going, kill yourself, kill yourself, kill yourself, for that guilt and the unforgiveness that he couldn't do for himself. And then the father was, I'm going to forgive you. So it was almost like the devil and the angel or God going, kill, don't kill, you know? So I saw that deeper connection.
I only ever saw her as just him, you know, that's inside of him, and that's the other side that you, every day you go, I can't believe I did. I just always saw her as her. I didn't really see her as her own character. I mean, I understood what the plot was, but I mean, from the very beginning when she first started talking, I said, that's him inside. Mm-hmm. That's, she's
yeah.
you. You know, she's the other side
yeah.
of you and what your torment you is, where you're mad.
Yeah.
Well, I appreciated Zell's character as the ambivalent or the dichotomy of what we feel as maybe even a society. The father has a just reason to kill the man who killed his daughter, or does his religion and whoever he's talking to tell him that he's supposed to forgive? He keeps waiting for the thing to tell him to kill him or to kill himself. And then he thinks, oh no, he's telling me to forgive. That's what I'm told to do. And Frank doesn't want to be forgiven because he's got that guilt and that pain is still there.
Yeah.
And he finds it difficult to deal with forgiveness. And it just dawned on me that that's what happens to Javert. And Les Miserables. He gets forgiven and he can't deal with being.
Where's our mayor? Oh, yeah.
I want to know about Haley. You know, I mean, seriously.
Oh, yeah.
A bitch. Because he saves her from this bad, possibly, you know, horrible childhood.
Right.
So, and then if we believe Zero, she was ignored for Haley. You know?
Uh-huh.
And so he comes back and says, my little baby's dead. You killed my baby girl. But from what Zero says, she was not, she was a second-class citizen in the household.
She says the only person who doesn't call her Zero is her father. So I think that.
He was a cousin, right?
Yeah.
Those are cousins.
Also, I think that there's that really beautiful detail about if I couldn't pronounce a word, Dad would make me practice until I could.
Mm-hmm.
Like that I have a fondness for Zell when I hear a detail like that.
Yeah.
Treatise on violence. I kept thinking about terrorism and jihad and, you know, the reference to the Middle East. It's a fascinating character that he's Arabic and Catholic or Christian or whatever, but I kept thinking that maybe there was something there that was going to be touched on, especially when he talked about coming over and killing himself in the backyard, because the whole idea of terrorist bombers and the fact that willing to sacrifice their own life for some other cause. So that kind of resonated with me, but it didn't quite get developed, and
mm-hmm.
I thought, you know, as a treatise on violence, that maybe was an area that could be developed further in the play
mm-hmm.
in some fashion.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Was Zell supposed to be Arabic? Or
what did you think?
I never got a feeling for, the name is so ambiguous, I never got a feeling for his background.
Mm-hmm.
Well, why was he there and how could he have bought her and all of that I thought left it up to you to figure out. He's not necessarily Christian either.
No,
he could very well be Muslim as well.
Hmm.
That's in the Quran as well.
It's going to be about Jesus.
Yeah, she said.
Yeah. Well, that's true. I forgot that part.
All right.
I enjoyed the use of the word bad, that Frank is bad.
Yeah.
And so he's the broken one.
Yeah.
He's the one that's messed up. But in all the characters, there's a great sense of brokenness. And what I enjoy about Zell and Frank so much is they seem to be dealing with their brokenness, while the other characters just bask in it. That's just unique. That's what drew me to Zell and Frank. Not to blow the other characters off,
right.
But in their roughness, they just wouldn't deal with that.
Right.
When those two in their ways were dealing with their brokenness. And their,
that makes sense.
Their struggle.
Yeah. Well, speaking of bad, maybe we should bring Nate up here.
Good.
Hey, would you just get us started here by talking briefly about where this play came from for you?
I felt like I noticed that there were like a lot of people getting shot in Walmart parking lots. And I'm not kidding, right? Like I know that it happened a couple of times, and so I asked other people about it, and they said, no, we're not noticing. And I asked my brother, and he and I usually, like, you know, we have the same internet history, I guess. And he was like, no, I didn't really notice that. And so I felt like I've noticed that when I am preoccupied with something, or when I am, when I feel like there's a pattern somewhere or something, it usually means that I'm already, like, composing in my head, and I should probably just lean into it, you know? And so, for whatever reason, that's kind of where that started. And the other thing was, as I woke up and I wrote down the sentence, a ghost haunts a monster. It was just like on my mind when I woke up, and it seemed like there was something there. And so those two things, and then some other stuff, like clearly, like some other stuff. Like narrative collapse, and the militarization of police, and the big business of grief in America. You know, minor stuff. Like that kind of fit together. That's where it started.
Yeah, we didn't even talk about the big, like the media and the big business of it all. Yes, sir.
I was listening to the radio this weekend, heard the report on the way you guys kind of had the workshops leading up to it and would read it and stuff. And if you could talk about a little bit, was the character that got shot a male at some point?
Or no.
Or did the genders flip-flop around a little bit?
No,
as far
not
as those characters? It didn't.
No, not for me.
Okay.
My job is sort of like to keep things as complicated as possible,
right,
like for me and you. And it seemed to be the most complicated choice to shoot a teenage girl that was in the commission of a crime.
Makes sense to me.
I feel like there's like a lot of the play is about Frank recognizing or failing to recognize, or however you want to describe that, it crossing a kind of moral event horizon. And it being super clear is important. And I think, I don't know why this is, but lately we have a tendency to say, well, you know, like 15, but he was stealing. And then we're like, that's kind of an adult. And I don't know why that is. I mean, that's still a kid as far as I'm concerned. And maybe no kids should be shot in parking lots, or definitely no kids should be shot in parking lots. But like if it was a girl, it seemed to be a little more complicated. So like right from the get-go, it was always that. You know what I mean? It was always a girl. She always didn't have a gun, and it was always jeans.
She was never black.
No, she was always
green.
That was
funny.
What
else do you want to hear Nate talk about? Yes, sir.
As a writer, I mean, these actors, we were just talking at the break, how fabulous it is to have Ingram have all of these things come together to put this event on. As a writer, to what extent did you hear these voices in your head when you were writing? Or do the actors bring their own voices? For example, Dump Truck. Right? How much of what we're hearing is what you expected to hear, and how much? And I'll open it up to.
Yeah. That's an awesome question. I don't think with this particular play I was working for any particular actor, and at the like when I started out, right? There are awesome actors here, you know? And so I got to have a wide array of really fantastic actors come in and hear them work on the play.
That's what we do in the labs.
So,
an actor.
so different actors read the plays at different
Yeah.
So it's not always
so
them.
Yeah, beyond these actors right here, Aaron Parker and Jen Richmond, Chris Bozen, Phil Perry, who's just here. What's that?
Do you cast?
The authors and the lab director and Renee all work together to figure it out.
For this.
And at a certain point, I really did get used to David Compton.
We all do.
But you know, like,
you just get used to it.
Well, no. Like the thing, like you start working on it, and you're like, oh, I think it would be cool to have this person in, or I think I'd like to work with this person, or whatever. And I mean, I will admit a little bit. I knew right from the beginning that I wanted to work with Megan on this particular role, right? And like initially, Josie had like so much to say. Like Josie was like, there was a lot of Josie, and I unfortunately had to cut down Josie really significantly. And she's still talking a lot. There's a lot to say. But like I'm getting away with a lot because Megan's awesome.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
For sure.
But that is one of the advantages of the lab, I think, is that the playwrights get an opportunity to hear variety.
How much changing? You know, because the other night we heard it went from 16 characters to 2. So did you have a huge change in
Like character and like the basics of the plot weren't really altered that much. Zell changed the most over time.
It wasn't a huge change the way.
No.
Wondering if it was this funny to you when you were writing it, and because I was sitting there, I was just imagining.
That's an awesome question. So there are times when you type and you're like, oh yeah, that's funny. Don't everybody want to drive all the way to Nashville to see titties, Frank? It's hilarious. Like you type and you're like, oh, that is funny. Well, I'm done for the day.
I was sitting here and I was, especially the sort of deadpan stuff from David and Jenny. I was just thinking. Actors could miss that, you know. Actors could play all that stuff in a more serious way, and so
I think a lot of that stuff doesn't always seem funny to me, right? Like so it and I think this is just like the natural way, like just hearing other people say it aloud is a lot different than you doing it by yourself in your office, you know. And so they always found the right way to go, and there were plenty of things that I thought were funny that weren't, you know. I know the play a lot better because of them and the program, right? Like that's very difficult to do on your own, you know. So there were plenty of things that I was like, oh, that's really funny to me, right? And it's not funny, right? It's just like, you know, like horrible, probably. Like oh, I don't know. or like they found, you know, like a really, you know, a lot in a line or a moment or something.
I mean, as a follow-up question, though, would it be fair to say, though, that it's one of the concerns of all the playwrights involved to figure out a way to get it on the page in such a way that subsequent productions of it would be able to interpret the way you want them to interpret it?
Yeah, that's kind of like the magic trick. I mean, like, they're in, I don't know, I have kind of a fake job, right? It's sort of a fake job, being a playwright. No, I mean it, right? But it's, like, hard, and one of the things that is hard is making sure that the things that are there are because they were really present in the play and somebody else would be able to pick it up. As opposed to, you know, like, it has everything to do with the actor that's doing it. I think David Compton's interpretation of dump truck eating a pizza roll. Right? Like, it's probably, like,
oh,
the funniest it's going to get. Like, if we can get near it, though, with some other dudes.
Can we get a video just of that?
Yeah. Well, it's, like, a really long stage direction now. What is Big Frank doing in the play? You mean you didn't see it, like you weren't sure why he was included? Yeah, I think,
pooping.
Well,
yeah. Major activity.
I'm interested to talk about that, but is there anybody that, like, was really into Big Frank, like, really wanted, like, that wants to talk about Big Frank?
It's not kind of what you do with it.
Sure.
Doesn't talk and he's over there, sort of.
I wanted to ask the same question.
Yeah.
But
I think.
What were you going to say? Oh, I was going to say for me, if it weren't for Big Frank, the most unbelievable part of this play could not have taken part or could not have happened because who would have ever thought a lawyer like her would have agreed to help change an opening night?
Mm-hmm. Sure. You know, that part, that's so weird. That actually came from a thing I read about a person who actually had that job, who's like is a crisis manager of sorts, and they were literally willing to do anything in order to get the client. And they were talking about the like worst things they would do because they're not exactly lawyers.
Yeah.
You know, and I was like, oh, this is right, this is important to me. I think the inclusion, and I think it's worth me re-examining, like, right, like I hear you guys. I think the idea is that this is a world of, like, this is a world of fathers, right? This isn't really like a mother play, this world of fathers, and they are absent, very absent. And this particular one gives us a little of information about what's going on with Frank, like what's going on in Frank's history, what's going on with Frank contemporaneously with his father. Like, he's a guy who shot a kid in a parking lot pretty close to the week that he took his dad in for cataract surgery, right? So there's like a piling effect there. And then as Dean pointed out, there's like the metaphor of like, you know, kind of old and decrepit America shitting its pants while half blind watching television on broken TV. You know? So like, yes, there is a breathing pants pooping metaphor over here in the corner. But I mean, I think that was the idea about it. And also, you know, it's July 4th, and I mean, I think the family always comes over.
Nate, one of my favorite lines comes out of a conversation about Big Frank, where he says, sometimes the army doesn't teach you something new, it reinforces what's already there.
Yeah. Turns it up.
Yeah.
So I mean, like as long as we're going to talk about like American patterns and all that stuff, it seemed worth it to physically embody it.
I just want to say, for me, because that was one of the first, I don't know, the first order, little Frank, Frankenstein, you know, there is a definite response to from him to him, you know, so it
sure.
Said something about Big Frank.
I also love with Big Frank, I would be very curious to count, like physically count how many times little Frank says yeah, right? Like that's his first six lines.
Yeah.
And I think when you're considering, like, we sent him away, why wouldn't we let him come back? And soldier and turning up the volume, those things that, like, all he can say is yeah. And now he is reduced to yeah. Is, like, super interesting when you consider, like, the American male.
Mm-hmm. Well, and they only check him out of the home for publicity. They check
him
out. They only check him out of the home for the publicity of the photos for Josie.
See, I need more stage directions.
Well, there is a line. What did you bring him for?
And she says, I mean, we checked him out of the home for this, Frank.
Oh, I didn't hear that.
I should have told you to say that.
Say it slower.
Say it
slower. And that's basically, we're all thinking about that bikini. Yeah, because it's like,
I appreciate that.
Thank you so much for being here, you guys. I think we should end the evening with applause.